Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 13th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2024. And the first item on our agenda this morning is to begin hearing oral evidence on the Scottish Languages Bill at Stage 1. And we're going to have two panels of witnesses joining us today, so it's a busy morning. Can I welcome our first panel of witnesses? We've got Douglas Ansell, and Anstall, apologies, it's... team leader Gaelic and Scots, Niall Bartlett, or is it Neil? Thank you. Policy officer Gaelic and Scots, Claire Cullen, head of Gaelic and Scots from the Scottish Government, Ninian Christie, lawyer from the Economy and Social Protection Division, and Nico McKenzie Uton, lawyer from the School Education Division, Scottish Government Legal Directorate. Have I got all of that right? Okay, thank you. Before we move to questions, Douglas Ansell will make a brief opening statement. I'm struggling to speak this morning. Statement. Douglas, you have up to 3 minutes. Thanks.
Right.
Oh, you don't need to press any buttons.
Press any buttons.
The tech desk does everything for us. It's hands-free.
Wonderful. Will they make the speech for me as well?
Sadly not.
Good morning and thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to give evidence this morning. Just a few words before I hand it back. The manifesto commitments of 2021 were the starting point for this bill. These commitments were positive and ambitious, and the Scottish Languages Bill is the vehicle, the legislative vehicle for these commitments. With Gaelic and Scots, it's always important to have a sense of earlier developments, to have a sense of what neglect we're trying to reverse and what progress we're trying to build on. For Gaelic, there was not much evidence of official support before the 1980s, nor investment in the areas where Gaelic was spoken. We need to look to the late 1970s and the 1980s to see important developments in terms of support for Gaelic medium education, broadcasting, publishing, the arts, and community initiatives. The establishment of the Scottish Parliament was also important, building on clear messages from the speaker community that much more was needed to be put in place for Gaelic. This led to the 2005 Gaelic Act, the establishment of Border Gaelic, preparation of Gaelic plans, standalone Gaelic schools, a Gaelic TV channel, further Gaelic support, and in the 2016 Education Act, much more support for Gaelic. As a result, we can safely say Gaelic is alive in many sectors. There are community initiatives and public bodies that have designed and adopted their own Gaelic strategies. Although the Gaelic world is small, it is varied and diverse and could never be described as all groups following one top-down Scottish Government official strategy. Gaelic development is also not standing still. A number of authorities are expanding their Gaelic medium education estate and provision, and a range of Gaelic bodies continue to strengthen their support for teachers, education, the arts, film, broadcasting and community initiatives. With examples such as this, we see Gaelic changing, growing and developing. It's not standing still. It's far from a status quo institution, but it's a varied mixture of individuals, community groups, public authorities responding creatively to a set of very challenging circumstances. So there is progress, innovation, and commitment, yet being positive does not blind anyone to the challenges which Gaelic faces or the concerns that are regularly expressed by speakers and learners. In our experience, nobody in Gaelic development is wearing rose-tinted glasses or has their head buried in the sand. There has been a similar but different story for Scots. We're aware that Scots was prominent in the past, at times the language of government and administration, featuring also in song, literature, in family and community life, yet Scots has also been excluded from public life and has suffered as a result. Like Gaelic, we're also mindful of the role of this Parliament in encouraging Scots, including the publication of the short parliamentary booklet entitled Scots, A Statement of Principles, which was published in the early years of this Parliament. Then a year ago, most of us will remember, Billy Kay was invited to the Parliament and delivered a positive, uplifting and inclusive moment of reflection in Scots. Also recently, our Cabinet Secretary launched a Scots learning course for teachers, prepared by the Open University and Education Scotland, where now over 150 teachers have signed up for this course of professional learning. The Scots Government has brought forward the Scottish Language Bill to build on the projects and initiatives that are in place, to improve on the progress that has been made, and to ensure that the structures of strategy, standards, areas of linguistic significance and plans operate effectively for the benefit of the speaker communities wherever they may be found. And so, in concluding, with the wider historical context in mind, the Scottish Parliament marked a turning point in support for Scotland's languages, and the speaker communities are keen to see this bill deliver good progress in line with their ambitions for Gaelic and Scots. Thank you. And of course, we would be happy to respond to any points or comments. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Douglas. Can I move straight to questions from the members, please? Sorry, I'm getting some noise through the headphones. Can I come to Liam Kerr to kick us off, please, this morning?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Douglas Anstall, I'll pick up on something you concluded with there. You said you're looking forward to, or the people are looking forward to, delivering good progress on the ambitions. If this bill is brought in, how will that success be measured for both Gaelic and Scots, and when does that measurement take place?
I think there are many measurements for Gaelic and Scots. I think local authorities have their own measurements, and I think we need to just, part of the discussion here is we need to think that things have moved on a lot since the Gaelic Act of 2005. Local authorities, public bodies, have their own strategies, have their own commitments, have significant spend for Gaelic and Scots. So, first point to make, local authorities and public bodies will measure what they do for their own commitments. The other thing where there will be measurement is there will be an enhanced role for Bord na Gaelic to consider reporting and to consider compliance reporting. So, a role for local authorities and public bodies, a role for Bord na Gaelic to report to ministers and to the Parliament. So I think there's a fair bit of reporting and following the commitments in the provisions.
That's not quite what I was getting at. It really, I mean, you talk about measurement as measure. Measurement has got to measure something. And you also talked, and I know my friend will come back on this later, about the significant spend. So what are the, if you like, the KPIs which show a positive returns on the sums invested? What does success look like in terms of what is being measured?
I'll start here by saying MG Alapa, Gaelic Broadcasting, have a range of targets that they judge their performance by, a wide range of targets. Sol Morostig, Gaelic College, has a wide range of targets in terms of student intake instead in terms of graduations. Local authorities have targets in terms of how many young people go into Gaelic medium education at primary one. And in some cases, for example, in Glasgow, the numbers wanting to sign up for Gaelic medium education are in excess of what Glasgow was considering. So these bodies all have their own measurements of success and can report on these also. Are we going in the right direction with these points?
Perhaps, but I'm still slightly struggling to decide or to isolate how the success of this bill will be measured. And perhaps the answer to that lies in the fact that it seems to me from looking through this that a large amount of the substance of any future language policy, and indeed the targets that you've just talked about, will be left to strategies, will be left to guidance, will be left to regulations, and indeed, it sounds like, for the individual bodies to define. Why is there not more detail on the types of duties that the public bodies, and indeed the targets that the public bodies, will have within the bill itself?
I think, let me take a fairly narrow example. Gaelic medium education. I think if you had a group of parents or Gaelic interests together, they would point to a range of things that they would like to see improved, changed in Gaelic medium education. For that reason, the many things we'd like to see focused on in Gaelic medium education will be included in the provision of the Gaelic standards. And in these will be drawn up the expectations for local authorities, for public bodies. The detail, that much of the detail will be in the standards and the strategy that are the provisions of this bill.
I see. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Mr. Kerr. Can we come now to Ben McPherson, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, all. Generally, the Scottish population has a good sense of what Gaelic medium education means and the benefits of it. I have Edinburgh's primary school in my constituency. I used to work in the high school here in Edinburgh that provides Gaelic medium education. But official status of the languages is something that may be quite new to many people and what that means. So can you tell us a bit more about how this will practically impact communities in Scotland? And how should the Scottish public sector, third sector and private sector interpret official status if this bill is passed and we move forward into that place?
I think the way the bill is, official status is to give recognition to the languages, Gaelic and Scots. The way that the provisions will impact is in the detail of the bill, in the provisions that follow. I think we'd probably agree that any minority community, any marginalised community in our societies would look for, first step, recognition. And I think if we, let's bring Scots into the discussion as well, I think we'd all recognise that Scots speakers feel discriminated against in terms of language, the language often being described as slang and not given adequate recognition. And so I think official recognition, a first step in giving recognition, but without any particular duties following from that statement. Would you like to add anything there?
Yes, thank you. So, Mr. McPherson, one example, I guess, is that every week we do have to explain to colleagues in public bodies and across government what GME is, what Gaelic medium education is, and the benefits that it entails. So, from your own personal experience, I think you're clearly aware of what those benefits are. But actually, that isn't a common position, and part of the bill is to act across a range of measures to try to improve awareness, to try to improve status, and to try to do what legislation can do in the status planning area. So legislation is never the full solution to improving the confidence or the belief in the language. However, we have tried to achieve as many measures as we can through the bill. So adding to what Douglas said earlier on in relation to measures of success, creating the conditions in which people feel confident to pass their language on to their children, creating the conditions where children feel confident to continue in GME, to seek out national qualifications, to be given access to national qualifications, to continue their learning journey so that it is not just stopping at primary school or at the end of a BGE, but that they have a vision to continue to study those languages and to develop their linguistic abilities in a range of domains so that they can take it into the work environment and pass it on and use it in service provision. All of these are markers of success, but they are pretty difficult to measure, and we need action across a whole range, a whole basket of measures in order to create those conditions and to provide state support. But that can only go so far.
Can I just come in on that as well?
Yeah,
so
sure.
Claire mentioned status planning, and that's one of the key aims of language planning, is that you raise the status of the language in its national context and for its speaker community. And giving official status to Gaelic and Scots will achieve that for the two. And it also draws on international examples. For example, we draw on Canada and the fact that French alongside English has official status there. And French in Quebec is one of the key examples we have of a language that has been successfully revived in the modern age. So it's not just us operating in a vacuum, it does draw on international examples of language development and planning.
So that was all really helpful, thanks. So just to be absolutely clear, this bill doesn't create new obligations. Because you said there would be no, I think it was yourself, Mr. Ansdell.
I will, of course, look to right and left here for
I just want to be absolutely clear on that point.
But there are obligations throughout the bill, but not necessarily flowing from the statement of official recognition.
Sorry, yes, thank you for clarifying that. That's what I meant. Okay, so official recognition gives the inherent good of acceptance, respect, all the things that you
recognition, emphasized. Indeed.
Yeah. Yeah. And sorry.
It would be notable in its absence, perhaps. Bill at this stage that didn't make a strong statement on status would be noticeable in its absence as well.
And I know we're going to come on to Gaelic medium education later, but I would just say that in my experience as a constituency MSP, the benefits to the capacity of young people to not just become excellent Gaelic speakers and communicators and writers, but also to then take on other linguistic skills and attributes. Often the young people in my constituency who are in Gaelic medium education speak multiple languages, actually. So it has an even wider benefit. So just something that I think is worth emphasising. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Pam Duncan-Glancy, thank you very much.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Good morning. I wanted to ask a question around the scope of the bill, and in particular as well, cross-portfolio working. So, as a starter, it's clear that cross-portfolio working will be necessary in this. Could you set out how much of that you've already done and how you think it will work in practice across government?
So some examples of changes that we've tried to make in the last couple of years, I guess, we have established a Gaelic implementation group, which Neil can speak to as he convenes that. The Short Life Working Group report on Gaelic and economy in order to achieve the Scottish Government response to that. A steering group has been set up to try to engage policy areas across Scottish Government in order to respond to the recommendations in that report, which fall within those areas. So that is being sort of coordinated by Gaelic and Scots. However, we are seeking to pull in and reach engagement through different portfolios. Neil can also speak to the numerous awareness sessions that he has done across government and across public bodies to raise awareness and to give the historical context, which are very well received and quite often lead to other policy ideas coming to our team and seeking input advice and allowing us to redirect them to stakeholders that we are in contact with, but who maybe other teams are not aware of. So in relation to education, Hayward, for example, we were able to ensure that the appropriate stakeholder groups were included in the work in relation to that. But it is an ongoing set of work. It is an ongoing, you know, people change, posts change, you know, it's a constant reminding.
I'll pass over to Neil in a minute, but I just want one small observation in that we have the system of Gaelic plans. And Bord na Gaelic will say to a range of public bodies, could you please prepare a Gaelic plan? And I think we've got well over 60 public bodies with Gaelic plans, public bodies and local authorities. And there's an interesting dynamic here. So Bord na Gaelic says to a public body, please prepare a Gaelic plan. That Gaelic plan is prepared, but that policy area, in effect, comes back into the Scottish Government, be it in environment, be it in heritage, be it in culture, in broadcasting. And so the request to prepare a Gaelic plan to whichever body will work back into Scottish Government. And we will, of course, try and follow up on these links also to strengthen cross-portfolio working.
Claire and Douglas have both mentioned the different initiatives we have in place that demonstrate cross-portfolio working already. We've got the Scottish Government's own Gaelic Implementation Group, which is for implementing the Scottish Government's individual Gaelic language plan, the Short Life Working Group on Economic Opportunities for Gaelic, and we've also got the Faster Rate of Progress Initiative, bringing together around 25 different public bodies active on behalf of Gaelic, and these each give an idea of how cross-portfolio working could be implemented under the Gaelic language strategy. The Gaelic Implementation Group, it's got representation from directorates across all parts of government, and I think its achievements over the last year demonstrate what this might look like. We've managed to successfully weave Gaelic, for example, into housing initiatives. Housing is obviously an acute issue across Scotland and the UK, but it takes on a particular salience in Highland and Island communities where Gaelic is still a majority language. We've managed to work constructively with the rural housing team to make sure Gaelic is woven into the rural and island housing action plan, and that their materials also go out in Gaelic so that they are fulfilling our wider language planning objectives. We're also working with the addressing depopulation team towards the same end. Obviously, we're based in the Education Reform Directorate. The greater bulk of our policy work is in education, and we successfully work with colleagues across different education portfolios as well. And beyond looking at immediate work, I think we can also look at examples of where efforts on behalf of Gaelic have in turn provided services of national utility. And just looking at education, in 2016 we worked with Cormhuireann and Éileann Siar to establish eSchool, the online learning platform that was designed in response to two major things. It was designed to overcome the shortfall in Gaelic teachers in Éileann and Siar, and also to deal with the particular geographical demands of an island constituency where distance learning was more of a requirement. That was 2016. Come 2020 and the pandemic, when suddenly the whole country is having to do distance learning, we have an eSchool, a service that can provide that, something that was originally designed in response to a distinctly Gaelic and distinctly Hebridean need. We can also look, for example, at the work we do in broadcasting, which is our biggest budgetary commitment. Beyond being an essential service on behalf of Gaelic, BBC Alpa, Raidan and Gael, and their various online platforms providing an essential service on behalf of Gaelic, which is deserving in its own right. We also look at how they've served for the general enrichment of Scottish society. For example, women's football, the advance that's made in the last generation has been hugely down to the platform it received on BBC Alpa, and the same is true for men's rugby. We can also look at the work we do with culture colleagues and tourism colleagues to make sure Gaelic is advanced there. We, Visit Scotland, have recently developed a Gaelic tourism strategy, and we know how important the Scotland's association with Gaelic is to attracting people not just to visit here, but also people to study here. Glasgow University recently set up its own Outlander course in recognition of the serious importance that had in drawing people to study Scottish history. And several careers ago, I was based at Glasgow University, and I can speak from personal experience the number of people who are drawn to study in Scotland due to the association of not just Scotland, but its higher educational sector with Gaelic and the work we all collectively
thank
do
you.
There.
Thank you for that. And it's really helpful to understand the depth of work that's going on. In your view, do the issues that you've spoke about briefly there, I think housing was mentioned, obviously the tourism and the economy, and also the Short Life Working Group on Economic and Social Opportunities for Gaelic, do any of those issues, and in particular some of the recommendations, come within the scope of this bill?
Yes, I think although these things are not policy issues that sit with our team, I think when we look at the key provisions of this bill, strategy, standards, and areas of linguistic significance, I think these infrastructural issues, issues of social and economic importance, will feature. And I think the bodies, let's pick a body such as Highlands and Islands Enterprise, that will probably be key to many of these provisions. Highlands and Islands Enterprise, transport, housing, infrastructure, economic issues, and that will overlap with their Gaelic commitments. So I think these issues will feature in the strategy, the standards, and as we move towards considering, as local authorities move towards considering areas of linguistic significance.
Thank you. That's really helpful. Do you think, though, that any provisions specifically in legislation, or, for example, amendments to the bill as it stands, are within the scope of this legislation that take in the broader issues that we've just discussed?
So if I could answer, I don't know whether this is the question that's being asked, but certainly we looked at the Short Life Working Group recommendations and picked out from those some of the recommendations that we felt would need legislative change to implement them. And those that we could take forward in this bill, we have tried to incorporate. So, for example, the Section 10 Land Rights and Responsibilities Statement, there was a suggestion in the Short Life Working Group that landowners should be making statements in relation to Gaelic. So the place in legislation where we had a land base obligation is being changed, but it's a statement that sits with Scottish ministers. So again, it's a sort of status and kind of reminding provision within the law, whereby something that could have happened anyway is now being put in law as a marker to sort of try to ensure that it's not forgotten. A similar provision in relation to further higher education, in relation to what ministers can do to provide instruction and direction to SFC. Again, we've got Gaelic now then in as a marker to ensure that, you know, when someone goes to exercise that power on behalf of ministers, it's very clear that Gaelic should be considered, and that reduces the chances of it being of policy being taken forward by omission, because we're all aware of the clear example that was given in 1872 Act for the Education Scotland Act, where, you know, compulsory education was put forward. It was put forward in legislation. That was a very positive thing for Scottish society in lots of ways. However, the failure to mention Gaelic led to significant damage to the language.
Thank you. And just one final question, if the convener will indulge me.
I can crack on.
Thank you. That's been really helpful. We are the Education Committee. This is largely an education bill. Are you able to share any information about the direction you were given from ministers about the scope and the detail in the bill?
We'd like to. If you're not in a position to, you can just say you're not in a position to. It's fine, and we can.
I'm not quite sure what areas the member feels are missing from the bill.
I suppose it's the question,
broadcasting, for example, there's maybe recommendations about broadcasting. Broadcasting is reserved, so we can't go into that. Mm-hmm. So this bill would never have been able to change broadcasting. That's a very clear example. I guess other areas, you know, it may be helpful to have examples to be able to answer.
That's fair enough. I suppose the question I'm asking is, can you help us understand why the bill is an education bill? And because we've got a lot of evidence around the...
Ms Duncan Glancy, if the bill team will know why this...
Just to see if you could share anything with us about the direction that was given to developing it.
I'm not sure I'll be able to give a very good response to that, but my... Just again, thinking myself into the process that we went through. So the manifesto commitments came to us, and for Gaelic and Scots, there were quite a few commitments. And these, in terms of finding headings for all of the manifesto commitments, one of them was a new strategy for Gaelic medium education. And there was quite a few things that went under that heading. To review the structures of Bordna Gaelic, that was another heading that some things fitted under. And another of the manifesto commitments was to explore the creation of a Gaeltacht. And there were some commitments in the 2021 manifesto that went under that heading. And then Scots, taking action on the Scots language. And as we worked through these commitments, there was a consensus developing, and there was support from ministers that these were the key headings that we needed to focus on in developing the provisions. So I might not have given a good answer, but that was the process that took us to what we have today.
Thank you. That's helpful. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Douglas. Can we come to questions now from Willie Rennie, please?
I didn't think Neil was going to stop with his list. It's a very impressive list, clearly on top of all the detail, and it is genuinely impressive, what you set out. I'm wanting to focus on the area of linguistic significance, or the Gaeltacht. Can you explain the point of it? Because it does seem a bit woolly and vague. What actual difference will people see who live in those areas?
I think the first thing to say is that there has always been a wish that Gaelic support and Gaelic development should be proportionate. Where there are more people, the support should be improved. The support should be stronger. And I think going back to the 2005 Act and the guidance that followed, there was still a wish that provision should be proportionate. And even if we went back beyond that Act, some people might remember there was a private member's bill from Mike Russell in 2002. And Mike Russell's MSP's private member's bill wanted a strong focus on areas where there was more speakers. So we as the policy team had the manifesto commitment create or explore the creation of a Gaeltacht, and we found in consultation that there wasn't much support just for a focus on areas where there might be high density or high percentage of speakers, because the focus or the preference was more Gaelic is throughout Scotland. There's four schools in Glasgow, there's speakers in Glasgow, Dundee, Edinburgh. It was more of an all Scotland. And so this policy device of areas of linguistic significance seemed to suit the profile of Gaelic in Scotland. It seemed to be something that could provide for areas where there were higher numbers, higher density of speakers, but it also seemed to offer something for areas where Gaelic was growing, Gaelic was being spoken. And so we see it as something that contributes to strengthening areas where there are significant speakers, but is also of benefit to areas where Gaelic might be growing in towns and cities. Am I going in the right direction?
No, that explains one. The origin of it. There does seem to be a slight contradiction that the general appeal was the direction of travel before, but now we seem to be focusing on areas of concentration as part of it. And I'm not saying it's an either or, but it does seem to be a different direction of travel. But the main point of my question is, what difference will it make?
Well, I think let's take the things together. Gaelic strategy, list of priorities, things that are expected, Gaelic standards. Again, what we have at the moment, we have two guidance documents for Gaelic, guidance on Gaelic language planning and guidance on education. And if we would expect that these two guidance documents would be strengthened as the strategy and as the standards are prepared. And then if a local authority decides to designate an area as an area of linguistic significance, bracket, as some of them have indicated they wish to do, if an area is designated as an area of linguistic significance, those local authorities will then look to the strategy and the standards and say, these are the expectations of what should happen in this area.
Okay, let me be a bit more direct then. If I arrive on the ferry at Loch Boisdale and that's designated as an area of linguistic significance, what do I see that's different? What do I hear that's different?
I think these things move in time, and this is not pressing a switch, overnight change, but as would be in front of me at the moment. But these things would affect, hopefully in time, hearing the language, seeing the language, also community provision for the language, and communications would be in Gaelic. So identity in terms of visibility, hearing the language, jobs for people that have Gaelic skills. So these are the things that we would hope would be in the strategy and the standards and would become more visible with time.
I wonder if Neil's got a list.
Just one example. Yeah. So we have, it's not, again, we're not just starting from scratch. Portion of Gaelic is currently developing community Gaelic language plans with different community organisations, and one of them is for UIST, where they're working with organisations such as Keolis Uisht, Storas Uisht, and other community bodies to give us a sense of how this might work in practice, and we'll be building on that.
Okay, right. Thank you very much. Sorry, Claire, did you want to come in on that?
I guess it was just to say that the way that we've asked for the standards powers would allow us to say, well, the X standard applies nationally and a higher standard applies for areas of linguistic significance. So that allows us to have a sort of flexible policy framework going forward into the future, which allows us to take, you know, recommendations from Bord na Gaelic or other language planning sources to say, okay, this is now accepted language planning, good practice, let's put it into requirements and let's move on and do the next thing.
Carry on. I've got Ruth wanting in on this theme as well, Willie, so I'm just trying to thread it all in. Yeah, Ruth McGuire, and then we'll come back to Willie Rennie.
Thank you, good morning, everyone. Just a quick supplementary on Willie Rennie's questioning. I guess from the perspective of speaker communities living in these areas, could their expectations be raised and met about being able to access services in their own language, about seeing more of their own language? Is that the sort of thing we're talking about practically?
That is the sort of thing that we're talking about practically, and also there is an element of language assertion and actually having the confidence to ask and having the confidence to access, having the confidence to go into the museum and say this, you know, this, it would be really good to see more Gaelic or into galleries and you know, point out that the Gaelic link, for example, is missing and therefore to show that demand.
And just really, can I really briefly, and Neil can scoop this up in his answer as well, and would that impact on other policy areas? Because I'm guessing some of the challenges we have is around, you know, housing, around having, you know, bringing in folk that have the language skills or that want to say they're so, I suppose an area having that status is of great value if it can influence other areas of policy, not just language and culture.
I think so, yeah, and I mentioned the UIST example. The other of the two community language plans Portion na Gaelic's working with is for the west of Lewis, and I can speak from personal experience, it's where I'm from. And that's somewhere where in the last generation, under the provision for Gaelic we've had since 2005, you've seen a big increase in the amount of the public sphere broadly that is dedicated to the language and letting people know that the language is to be encouraged there. And one of the key factors here is how this has gone hand in hand with the growth in community land ownership and the creation of community-owned estate trusts, which have become the key anchor organisations in these communities. And through their work, they do tie Gaelic in with the more general provision of public service to which they're central.
Thank you.
Willie Rennie, thank you for allowing that.
No, that's good. Thanks to Ruth McGuire for that. Just tell us a bit more about the standards, not just in these areas of linguistic significance, but across the country. How, explain it to me how they'll work, what kind of standard we're rising to, and what difference will people in Edinburgh, Glasgow and elsewhere feel?
So, for example, there are bodies who have had 3 Gaelic language plans, and there are discussions at each point around the logo of that body, the visibility of signage within that body's estate. In order to make the system more efficient and to kind of move past that, it would be very helpful to have those sorts of requirements, provisions put in standards that are then non-negotiable. And, you know, while they may be applied flexibly and while bodies may be given time to kind of comply with that, those are accepted in Scotland as a language planning measure. And then the discussions between Bord na Gaelic and the bodies about how they can do more for the language are not tied up in sort of revisiting measures which really should be accepted practice.
Okay. I think the standards would also step into the education area as well. And actually, let me just... This is in international discussions as well. Wales have gone down this route as well and have very detailed standards in place. But the standards should also include things that, like the parental access to Gaelic medium education, continuity of Gaelic medium education, early years, primary, secondary, resources being provided for young people in Gaelic medium education, professional learning for teachers that are teaching in Gaelic medium education. These things could also feature as expectations. And I think expectations is a good word because parents and Gaelic interests could know what is expected, and local authorities and public bodies and government should know what is expected provision in these places in different sectors, be it corporate, be it education or whatever. And I think, as Claire mentioned earlier, I think consideration should be given to a level of standards, maybe standards more higher expectation where there is an area of linguistic significance that has been designated.
Thank you. I suppose following on that theme of standards, though, some of the respondents were unclear about how public bodies' compliance and accountability processes would work in practice with the legislation and any sanctions that these public bodies might face. Cumna Gaelic, hopefully that's right, questioned whether a government agency would even be critical of the Scottish Government in meeting these aims. So I was wondering how the legislation might address some of those points.
Okay, well, I'll start. So for the education sphere, I guess the standard enforcement discussion is Section 70 of the 1980 Act. So if a parent has an issue with how education is delivered, they can make a complaint to Scottish ministers. That's considered... So that applies to education in English. It would apply to education in Gaelic. That's one route. At the moment, Bord na Gaelic has some powers, some of which have been used, some of which haven't, to refer to ministers if they have a dispute. So that's around a setting of Gaelic language plans. If Bord na Gaelic and a body don't reach agreement about the terms of the Gaelic language plan, then that can be referred to ministers. Ministers consider both points of view and can potentially take evidence from other people.
Claire, is, you know, Orkney have come in as well and said that some of the reporting processes should be proportionate, as Gaelic is not a priority for the local community nor the education authority.
Indeed.
So in terms of that variable, you know, in terms of sanctions and expectations, you know, how
Indeed.
Are we going to manage that?
Indeed. Well, the way that the bill has been structured and that the powers that have been requested and designed are to allow differential application across Scotland for educational matters. So at the moment, the standard power that we would use in education to set a standard for schools is Section 2 of the 1980 Act. That can only really be used to provide a blanket requirement on all schools. That is the power that would be used to set class sizes or to set, you know, it was used initially to require period products to be made available before the bill came in. Nico can give a list of examples, I'm sure, about other exercises of that power. But that power, as I say, it can only set a blanket standard. And so therefore, it's not actually that helpful for Gaelic and Scots, because Scots will be more spoken in certain areas, Gaelic will be more spoken in certain areas. And therefore, the powers that we've asked to set standards does allow for differential implementation, both in terms of application. So it may not be that it may be that Orkney doesn't have any duties placed on it due to in relation to Gaelic due to its demographic. However, it would allow that differentiation. So that is relevant here, but I guess the question was about enforcement.
Enforcement and sanctions, if it's such variability across the country as to who's got to provide what and what their obligations are, how do you have a sort of something that are the sanctions that's understandable, is fair, proportionate, and represents that's going to be quite confusing and sort of resource heavy for all sorts of people, stakeholders in this, is it not?
So in terms of reporting, the bill changes what Bord na Gaelic...
Maybe I didn't mean reporting, because I am more interested in the sanctions that will be placed if people aren't fulfilling their obligations.
We're not proposing to put any financial sanctions on bodies. That's something that I think Wales do. You know, the bill is trying to increase the status and the visibility and the appreciation and respect of Gaelic and Scots across the nation, but it's not trying to do that by penalising. It's trying to do that by pull factors, by encouraging. So we, at the moment, Bord na Gaelic have, for example, an ability to report to ministers if they feel that a body is not complying with something in its Gaelic language plan. Now, they haven't actually done that to date. In order to do that, they have to show failure, which is kind of quite a high bar. So what we've introduced here is a power for Bord na Gaelic to issue reports on Gaelic generally and to be able to send them directly to ourselves, but also directly to Parliament, so that Parliament could, one of its committees or Parliament could consider itself how it wishes to provide scrutiny, support and challenge to what public sector are doing for Gaelic. And in relation to Scots, because we don't have a specific body set up there, then the power in the bill is for reporting, for Scottish Minister to make sure that reporting is done in relation to Scots and the status of Scots, but that we can either do that ourselves or we could potentially outsource that to a body.
Jumping ahead, before I come back in, Liam, I was still curious about what are the consequences of people not fulfilling their obligations and the reporting duties. So, but we'll see if we'll leave that one. That you said that you decided not to establish a Scottish language body, a Scots language body, to support that part of the language bill. So what are the reasons for that? Jumping ahead.
I think first thing to say, we understand the wish for this. We've seen the comments coming in, both in terms of in our consultation and the comments going into to the call for evidence. There are Scots structures being put in place, and I think that's important. There are a number of Scots bodies that are in place and that we work with and that are funded. And I think in the provisions of the bill, in the preparing of guidance, in the preparing of standards, there is an inviting Scots bodies and leaders of Scots bodies to contribute to the preparation of these documents that are needed for Scots, be it guidance or standards. So there is a structure in there that's important for Scots bodies and pulls them into the provisions of the bill.
I understand that, but I was just wondering what the reasons were for not having... But that's fine, we can move. Liam Kerr, you have a supplementary, very briefly, before we move to Ruth McGuire.
Yeah, I'm very grateful. Just very briefly, Claire Cullen, you mentioned Wales, and I was interested in my friend Ben McPherson's questions earlier when he asked about official status, and Willie Rennie asking about what difference designating an area of significance would make. Now, I think the Welsh language was given official status in 2011. So when drawing up this bill, what research was done about what difference that made in terms of the Welsh language, such that we can learn lessons for this bill?
We certainly have looked at language legislation across a number of jurisdictions. We are actively engaged in the British Irish Council on their sector for minority languages, and that's a forum, a very useful forum for sharing good practice and for sharing ideas and evidence. I think it would be very, very difficult to pinpoint what the differential impact would be of the status statement in Wales, because that didn't happen in isolation. It happened with a full structural change, but certainly it is accepted to be a positive move forward.
So just to be clear, it's not possible, when you were researching this, it was not possible to say whether the designation of the Welsh language in 2011 as an official language made a difference, a measurable difference.
I don't think it would have ever been pinpointed to say it made, you know, it led to 100 people passing on their language to their children. You know, it wouldn't be counted in that way, but it certainly helps and it certainly is an important factor in status planning.
Fascinating, because the official recognition doesn't come either in our legislation or in Welsh by itself. There's a range of provisions that come at the time, for example, in Welsh, with regard to Welsh language schemes, with regard to Welsh language education. And so the recognition, official recognition, and of course use of Welsh in the courts and in a whole range of areas of public life. So the recognition sits with a wide range of provision.
Thank you. And I've actually jumped ahead of myself. It's Bill Kidd we're coming to now for some questions. Thank you, Bill.
Thank you very much, Convener. Now it's been mentioned a couple of times about the board and how its role is at the moment, but how would that, the actual organisation's remit change following the bill and what the aims of the bill are?
So there's some activity that the board currently lead on, which Scottish ministers will bring back into Scottish Government. Examples of that are that the strategy for Gaelic, instead of it being drafted by Bord na Gaelic and approved by ministers, ministers will take that strategy on again. That's to generally increase the visibility and the leadership in relation to that. Bord na Gaelic would say, I have heard them say on numerous occasions, that the National Gaelic Language Plan is not their plan. The National Gaelic Language Plan is a plan for everybody. It requires actions across all public bodies. And therefore, by elevating that sort of piece of the jigsaw up to ministers, you know, ministers have a more direct relationship and a more sort of directive and funding relationship with the range of bodies that would be seeking to contribute, as opposed to that being, you know, a discussion between NDPBs, which Bord na Gaelic have expressed that they're content for that to come to us. So that's one example of a change. It's not that they will be excluded, they will still be very included in that, and it was always subject to kind of consultation across bodies and public consultation. So we would certainly still be seeking to consult in relation to the preparation of the strategy, but it's just a sort of change of resource or a change of emphasis. Similarly for the guidance, there's two guidance making powers which were given to Bord na Gaelic. It's quite unusual in legislation to see statutory guidance being promulgated by an NDPB, and therefore on review and in discussion we think it's preferable to bring that back into Scottish ministers to ensure better engagement and tie-in across portfolio working as well. So those are a couple of examples where they're changing.
Can I just give you some large headings we'd still expect Bord na Gaelic. Bord na Gaelic will, of course, promote the language. Bord na Gaelic will support everything from local authorities and public bodies to communities. Bord na Gaelic will help with implementation. Bord na Gaelic have significant funding. Some funding goes to local authorities, but also to small Gaelic community organisations, and the compliance role. So these roles of promotion, support, implementation, funding and compliance will remain with Bord na Gaelic.
Thank you, Jude. Well, that's really helpful, actually, to give us a stronger view and knowledge background on what the board its role actually is at the moment and how it's going forward. Are there reasons, though, for choosing not to establish a Gaelic commissioner to go along with these roles and promote them, if you know what I mean? Sort of thing?
So we have heard the calls for Gaelic Language Commissioner and Scots Language Commissioner. For example, that works in Wales, where there are set standards already. There's very specific requirements on bodies at this point in time. Scotland will be moving to exercise the standards and to bring in those in, but we don't feel that it's an appropriate time to bring a commissioner in. You know, in terms of the financial investment, that money could be better spent in, on the ground in development through grants to community bodies, etc. That's certainly, we feel that there is more opportunity for Scottish Government leadership and public bodies working together collaboratively and being positive about the language to make a lot of progress rather than having an ombudsman in an adversarial role at this point in time. Referring back, I guess, to the point that, you know, the Bord na Gaeilge have had a power since 2005 to defer to ministers, examples of where they feel that someone, that a body is not complying with the requirement of its Gaelic language plan, that hasn't actually been exercised, and it could have been if that was felt to be a helpful way to take things forward.
Very briefly, again, it might not be relevant, but just also to keep in mind when the Welsh Assembly established the Welsh Language Commissioner, the Welsh Language Board ceased to be, and that moved into the Welsh Government. So that was the move they made at the time. That's just something we kept in mind in our considerations as well.
And I'll just to sum up on that then, am I wrong in saying that possibly the funding that's available is better spread on the ground through the board than more top-down sort of... So.
Yes, most of Bord na Gaeilge's funding goes out the door from... to a range of sources, from small community groups to local authorities, public bodies that do things for Gaelic, significant funding goes out the door and indeed encourages additional spend in these places that the money goes to.
That's excellent. Thank you very much indeed for that.
Thank you, Bill Kidd. Can we come now to Ruth Maguire, please?
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to ask about Gaelic education. The Bill makes changes to the statutory definition of school education. Could you tell the committee what the position is now in terms of local authorities' obligations to provide Gaelic medium education, and what will be different after the, if and when this bill becomes an act?
So the changes to the 1980 Act are to ensure that at the moment it's permitted. Gaelic education is permitted under the definition, but it is restricted in that to Gaelic-speaking areas. Now, that was never defined in the 1980 Act, and to a certain extent, it looks like it's limiting it to areas which are Gaelic-speaking. So we have felt it more helpful to ensure that Gaelic education is included in what can be permitted and that that is not geographically restricted.
Nicole? Yeah, I'm happy to come in on that. So basically, I think it's important to see that particular change of Section 15 of the bill in context of what it is amending. So basically, what we're not changing is Section 1.1 of the 1980 Act, which requires education authorities to secure for their area the provision of adequate and efficient school education, among other things. So that remains the same, and it remains education authorities that are principally responsible for determining what it means, what is adequate and efficient for their area. So what we are changing is the definition of school education, which kind of plays into that, and how Gaelic is integrated into that. As Claire said, currently that says the teaching of Gaelic in Gaelic-speaking areas, it's a bit ambiguous in that what is a Gaelic-speaking area in 2024? Is it what it was in 1980 or in 1945, whenever these provisions are from originally? So we're trying to be clearer, basically, about that school education includes Gaelic in Scotland, and that in their determination of what constitutes adequate and efficient school education for their area, education authorities should be thinking about whether Gaelic medium education and Gaelic learner education is what is required. to meet that test.
Okay, so at the moment, I suppose thinking of the sort of practical implications, at the moment, let me give the example of my area, Cunningham South in North Ayrshire. So there hadn't been Gaelic spoken widely for a fair amount of time. There is a Gaelic medium education unit there because there was interest and parents wished to educate their children in Gaelic. What I'm trying to understand is if there is an additional obligation on local authorities now, what's their obligation at the moment, and will there be an additional obligation with this change?
What we're not doing is imposing a duty to provide Gaelic education. Okay. In each education authority. That's not what the bill is doing. I think what we're doing is we're clarifying that what is within the scope of that key duty of an education authority when they're planning what school education would be adequate and efficient for their area. So we're trying to remove the ambiguity more than anything else, you know, that reference to the teaching of Gaelic and Gaelic-speaking areas, which is poorly understood, mm-hmm. I think, what that was meant to mean.
I'm still not entirely clear. I don't know. It may just be me. So what is it at the moment that is empowering local authorities that aren't areas with large numbers of Gaelic speakers to set up Gaelic medium education?
So the 2016 Act is relevant here. So the Education Scotland Act 2016 provided a process which allowed parents to come to their local authority to ask for Gaelic medium education to be established. So when you look back at the successes of Edinburgh, Glasgow, Condorcet, the Gaelic first policy in the Corlin Inland Shire, those have started by conversations where parents have come to an authority and said, can I have Gaelic medium education for my child? And those have been openly accepted and positively responded to. Not all conversations to request Gaelic medium education have resulted in action or have resulted in action quickly, and therefore the 2016 Act sought to provide a process which allowed a parent to make a request where five children can be demonstrated to be of interest for that age group. The local authority then is required by law to carry out a full assessment. And we are making some changes to that in the bill in relation to extending that process to early learning and childcare, in recognition that the earlier a child comes to Gaelic medium education, the better the cognitive outcomes and the better their fluency will be, etc. So that's another measure that we're trying to do. And the changes to the 1980 Act are just one small element of that. So that all of these provisions lie together and will be considered. But if you're sitting in the local authority and thinking, can I do this? Is this part of something that I can do? Then it always was something that could be provided and that was within the powers of the local authority to do. We just feel that the provision of limiting it geographically in the 1980 Act is unhelpful and could lead to authorities saying, well, we're not a Gaelic-speaking area, therefore we won't respond, when there might be actual demand and there might be teachers and it might be possible. And therefore, again, for status planning, you know, we're trying to remove something from legislation which we think helps, adds to the negativity.
So it's about removing a barrier rather than putting in an obligation, is that correct?
That's a much more concise way to say it.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you for that. Okay. Can I ask about the duties envisaged to be included in Gaelic education standards? And if these will differentiate in different parts of the country. I mean, I would hope that standards wouldn't differentiate, but maybe duties might.
So it will be possible to have differential application of standards, so that, for example, so that they don't catch Orkney if that's not relevant, or that they don't catch Corlin Inland Shire in relation to Scots if that's not relevant. So there is an element of flexibility designed to ensure that the requirements are proportionate and the requirements are appropriately laid, and consultation with local authorities and with communities in relation to reaching that point. Did you ask for an example of what a standard could be in relation to education?
I think, yeah, I asked how they might differentiate in different parts of the country. I mean, you spoke there, but give the example of Orkney. I guess that's helpful.
I mean, one of the things we will look to, I mean, obviously the standards haven't been drawn up yet, but one of the things we'll look to is the 2017 guidance on Gaelic education. And the 2017 guidance, which follows the 2016 Act, has a fairly detailed set of expectations of what Gaelic medium education should look like. And I think looking ahead and just with the guidance in our thoughts, I think that the standards for Gaelic medium education will include things like what are the provisions for young people to have access to early years or to Gaelic medium education, what is a local authority doing to promote Gaelic medium education, how will it secure continuity from early years to primary to secondary, what's available at secondary in terms of secondary subject choice, questions of 0 to 3, 3 to 5, class sizes, support from national bodies, out of school education. I think all of these things I'm not wanting to rush ahead and set down what the standards should contain, but I think there's a fair guess. These are the things, taking our lead from the 2017 guidance, these are the things that we would expect to find in the standards as they apply to Gaelic medium education.
Okay. And finally, convener, if I may, can I ask about the availability of Gaelic speaking teachers, of specialist education staff? We spoke there about early learning professionals as well. What consideration has been given to addressing, because I think there is at the moment a challenge with supply of these staff, and obviously as we look to expand, we don't want that to get in the way. So what consideration has the Scottish Government given to that?
I'm looking at the time as convener, so if you can maybe provide quite snappy answers, please, that would be helpful.
I'll try and be quick. With teachers, it's always what different pathways and routes can we find into teaching? And I think for teachers, we're always looking at the standard routes at university, online and distance learning, immersion courses that help teachers transfer from English teaching to Gaelic teaching, and also recently the teacher's bursary scheme offering 20,000 a year for people that might want to learn and go into Gaelic medium education. So we're always looking at what routes and how to make these routes better to attract and to pull people into teaching. Sorry, Claire, go.
I was just going to suggest, because obviously it's quite a big question, I wonder would you maybe be able to write to the committee and include the bit about early learning, because I think, as you've said yourselves, that kind of whole through route is important.
And subject choice, of range, etc. would be helpful. Thank you. Is that all? Thank you for... Okay, cheers. Ruth Maguire's just finished now. Can we come back to Bill Kidd, please? Thanks.
Yes, thanks, convener. Can we hear wee Duke round the corner and talk about the Scots language for a minute or two? The bill will recognise and support the Scots tongue. How will it do this? And also, how will you measure success on the different dialectical variations across Scotland in doing that, please, if that isn't too complicated?
Okay, so the definition of Scots in the bill is wide and inclusive, and it's intended to incorporate all variations of Scots.
To measuring success on dialectical variation, you'll obviously have seen Orkney Council's submission and their concerns that a standardised mainland version of Scots would be imposed. We're mindful of that. The commitments that the provisions in the bill stem from, we're mindful of the variety of Scots that exists in the country, and that we are dealing with a significant range of dialects bound up with strong regional identities, and I think that is something we're going to be mindful of. You're going to be hearing later from Dr. Michael Dempster of the Scots Language Centre. He as well has raised that in the submission on behalf of the Scots Language Centre. And I suppose one of the key things might be that it does come down to local authorities. They're aware of which dialects are most pertinent to them. And when it comes to developing this aspect of the legislation, it's to be mindful of that. We have from the outset been mindful that when you're dealing with Scots, you're dealing with the various range of dialects within Scotland that come under that term.
I know that Ninian looked as if he was interested there. And Claire, did you want to finish off there? Was that?
You were asking about, I guess, measures of success, and I think similarly to Gaelic, the provisions in the bill partly are to try to ensure that the status of Scots is improved, that the authorising environment is changed to allow use in the classroom. So Scottish Government already provides support to a number of bodies which produce educational resources. They're free to use, but sometimes teachers have been prevented from using them in the classroom because of an attitude that it's not appropriate. So trying to show leadership in that space to ensure that that can be brought in. But again, there's no move from Scottish Government to centralise or standardise the language. If that happens through the community, that's something that we could certainly work with on, but it's not part of the Scottish Government agenda, and we don't think that it would be particularly helpful. And I think we mentioned the last time we were at committee in relation to the informal session that we gave, that we just had the OU Education, the Open University Education Scotland session for continuing professional development, and the really positive uptake that there was there. So that allows teachers to develop materials and learning lesson plans in community with other teachers in their own context. That has been signed up to by primary school teachers, by geography teachers in secondary school, by language and literature teachers. So it's a wide range, and it's the idea at this stage is to ensure that those that are interested are supported and given the confidence and the resources to bring that into the classroom.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Liam Kerr?
Yeah. Just Claire Cullen, I'll push you on that. You talked there about the resources for teachers. Now, if there is no standard definition of Scots, i.e. it includes, which I think I was hearing from you, that it would include Doric, it would include Orkley Norn, it would include, I don't know, Lallan Scots, then by definition you will need different resources at different parts of the country. And you will also need teachers who are trained and recruited who are able to deliver those resources. How much will that cost, and where in the financial memorandum can I find that?
So it's not about imposing Scots on teachers. It's about teachers who come from those backgrounds and who have that Scots to be able to use it and to be able to understand it. And that the Open University course that's been put in place is the beginning of that journey to allow teachers. Scottish Government are paying for the places on the course. That's a first step in allowing those teachers to come together and to develop their own resources in their own contexts. And that is similarly done in Curriculum for Excellence in classrooms up and down the country, for all subjects, not necessarily in relation to language, but the materials in relation to history or geography may be amended relative to the place in which it's been delivered.
So just to be absolutely clear, once these teachers are trained and deployed in the schools, they will develop in their own time and off their own bat the resources that they will then teach, and they will translate the textbooks and the like. So there'll be no cost.
Well, many of the resources exist already. Scots, various forms of Scots, have got quite a deep history of printed literature, which can be drawn upon. It's available from the National Library of Scotland, Education Scotland's produced material as of stakeholders such as Scots Hoose. So there is a lot of printed material there already, but also a lot of the emphasis on the use of Scots in education is on the reality that it's largely encountered in speech. And it's just giving children a broader awareness of the differences in how they might speak between the classroom, the playground, and home, and using that to an extent as the text. And we have got various bits of research showing the benefits of this. There are initiatives underway in different schools across Scotland working in this vein, and research such as Glasgow University's Future of Scots project, as well as by the Scottish Book Trust, has shown the advantages of this in areas such as improving attainment and also just enriching the wider understanding of language, whether that's the forms of Scots used out with the classroom or the form of standardised English encountered in the classroom. So again, we aren't just starting anew. We're building on work that does exist already.
Mina.
Is there anything you want to bring in on that, Stephanie Callaghan?
Yes, please. Thank you, Convener. I think as well, you've spoken about it already, really, that accessibility as well, because Robert Burns or Walter Scott can be quite difficult for all of us, and it's really about that language in the playground and in the homes that people are using there as well. I'm wondering about how can that be supported through teacher training and professional development as well, and be embedded in our education agencies too? And I'm also interested as well on how you think it might address stigma for young people as well about how they speak.
I think the addressing stigma, I think we need to recognise there we're on the road and we're all pushing back against that. And again, this isn't something that will be changed overnight. And it's something that's deeply held and deeply felt by the Scots language community, the stigma. In terms of support for teachers, for a number of years, the Scottish Qualifications Authority, SQA, has had in place Scots language awards and Scots language units. And the SQA has had sessions for teachers to offer professional learning, to offer support for these Scots language awards and Scots and units. Education Scotland has Scots language capacity and supports teachers and have sessions in schools. And now the Open University materials, we've got 150 teachers signed up for this professional learning, to do the learning, to step back into schools. Friday, just last week, I was in Denbeath Primary in Fife. And I was taking part, oblique, observing a lesson where Matthew Fitt from Scots Hoose was doing lessons with primary 4-5 and primary 6-7. He was doing lessons with the young people, but also bringing the teachers in. So it was both teachers were participating and learning. So who's supporting teachers? OU, Education Scotland, SQA, Scots Hoose, I'm expecting with the provisions of the bill focusing on education, this will only be strengthened.
What changes, if any, would you expect to see?
I think we'd expect to see
wards and units. Would there be any expectation of changes there?
I think the awards will continue, that from the SQA, the Scots Language Awards and Scots Language Units. I think we'd hope to see an increase in uptake. Similar to Gaelic, I think when these things are put down either in strategy, Scots, or standards, Scots, that improves the expectation. It improves the expectations of what parents can expect in the classroom and what teachers, local authorities should expect to deliver in certain circumstances. So I think growth and improvement in quality.
Can I move now to questions from Michelle Thompson, please? Thank you.
Yes, good morning. Good morning. I wanted to chat a little bit more about the financial memorandum, and there's been some questions that have bounced around from that as we've been going through the session today. Now, looking at the FM itself, the total anticipated spend is £694,000and £500, so it's obviously not very much. It's not a significant spend. So I'm trying to understand to what extent you really want to create a shift here, or you want to do a bit of moving things about a bit. The financial memorandum figure would suggest that it will allow for some moving about a bit, but am I wrong in that? Are you really trying to create a significant shift?
We are trying to create significant shifts, but I think we're trying to do so principally by reprioritisation, by improving the standards, improving the status, improving the visibility, you know, doing what government can do in terms of legislation. That is a slightly separate thing to how much money year on year is applied through the budget process to Gaelic and Scots. That is for the budget bill. That's decided year on year. There is significant spend by Scottish Government, you know, £29 million in our budget, but there's other budgets with the cross-portfolio working, with the cross-government working that we are continually engaged in. There are other budgets within Scottish Government which act positively for Gaelic and Scots. There's budgets which Scottish Government give to NDPBs, which then will act positively for Scots. So it is a slightly... They're slightly separate questions in a way, and we would always be keen to, you know, to see more investment.
Yeah, and this is what I want to try and explore. I mean, I can see why creating provisions that allow for activity or provide clarity, some of which we've already discussed, can add value. But even like the £29 million you talk about, I mean, that's been the figure since, what, about 2010. So in 2010, if you spent a pound, you'd have to spend roughly £1.50 today to get the same value. So in reality, it's a real terms decrease since 2010. And I suppose I'm just struggling to understand how it's really going to make the difference that people are looking for based on those figures. And if you don't mind, I just want to quote a couple of organisations that have given evidence to the committee. Mishnia Khalpa says, whilst on paper the bill mostly provides for regulatory changes which should not incur direct costs, and it goes on, it's difficult to see how new or indeed existing provision for Gaelic can be implemented in a way which meets the scale of the challenges, as well as the government's commitment to have a focus on arresting language shift in areas with significant speaker numbers without meaningful funding increases. Are they wrong?
So allocation of budget to areas of linguistic significance would never have appeared in the bill. That is a separate process.
First of all, completely understand we work with the Scots language community and the Gaelic language community. We understand the requests for additional resources and sometimes we feel them quite acutely too. But focusing on the spend from our team is only one part of the picture. One of the things that has changed significantly since the 2005 Act is the spending commitments that have come from local authorities and from public bodies. And if I've mentioned a few public bodies such as Creative Scotland, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, SDS, Skills for Development Scotland, Nature Scot, Education Scotland, SQA, if we picked on the budgets that they have for Gaelic and Scots that have increased over the years, there's significant spend in there. And this significant spend is going on and is increasing without the provisions of this bill. For example, one local authority committed last year £12 million to capital provision for a new school. Now, there was no obligation that expected that local authority to do that. The Creative Scotland commitment to support Gaelic and Scots is impressive also. So there is significant spend, not just from our team's budget, which has increased also, but from local authorities. And I think looking at the Gaelic and Scots enterprise in its broader sense does draw a picture of significant spend also from other sources.
The other point I meant to say was that, you know, what the kind of finance related power that you would expect to see in bills is a power to make payments, so a power to make grants for particular purposes. But we actually looked at the education powers and the cultural powers that we've got already to make grants, and we felt that there was no gap in the powers that are available to Scottish ministers to make payments for the purposes that we would want to make them through existing legislation. So that's something that we haven't addressed in the bill, but it's not because we don't want to invest, it's because we don't need a legislative provision to allow us to do that. So any discussions are for the budget bill.
Okay. So some of what you're saying is clear, because we're, you know, and I totally understand both the range of bodies who are undertaking activity that's within the existing budgets and the increase in activity being enabled by a groundswell of opinion to promote and support Gaelic and further push and promote Scots. I think we're nodding, so it looks like we've agreed on my understanding so far. I just still am rather confused as to, in terms of the overriding intentions of the bill to shift the dial, particularly for Scots, I would say, because at least there is an existing infrastructure, it sounds like a growing infrastructure for Gaelic. But, you know, where are we in shifting the dial, or is this a gentle step forward for Scots? What would be your articulation of that? In your own words, obviously.
Look, 2005... The Gaelic Act passed, and what was put in place at that time were important structures and changes. And at the time when that bill was going through Parliament, it didn't come with budgets attached. It came with structure, shape, expectations. And it has led, to an extent, some would of course want more, it has led to a culture change, it has led to spending commitments. Now, your question to me, I hope we would make gentle changes that would in time shift the dial.
Michelle, you briefly, because I know Liam wants in, I've got an eye on the clock, but has okay. got something?
No,
and Claire wants to respond
as
well.
I think you've answered my question, and you've answered it very honestly. I appreciate and understand it takes a long time to shift culture. And I suppose my last question quickly is that given, I mean, I'm very supportive of this. I'm very supportive of it, but I just know how long it takes to change culture. So I suppose that's why I'm probing, is it enough to change the culture given the backdrop where English is so pervasive and the moves against Indigenous culture are so pervasive?
That's a great question. I love that question. And some of the things that come to us, I think working in a Gaelic and Scots team, you get it from both sides. You get people saying it's a waste of time, forget it. And you get, of course, there's people that want more, understandably, and we and so the comment sometimes comes to us, it's not working, why do you bother? And I think we need to look on this as you're suggesting, as a very large programme of social change. And very often the example is given of it's like turning an oil tanker. You put in the interventions, and there's not a few interventions, there's many interventions from early years in different sectors, and you hope and expect that these interventions are going to turn the oil tanker and move things towards a more positive place. And we can see examples of good progress, And our hope is that an expectation is that the provisions of this bill will strengthen and will keep that movement going in the right direction.
Clear? No, you're okay? No. Liam, have you got a brief supplementary?
Yeah, just on Michelle Thompson's point, which I agree is very interesting. So if you start from a position that says it's for the local authority or Creative Scotland to choose to implement, to promote what this bill is trying to do, to invest, then in a context where budgets are very tight, if it is a free choice for the local authority, for example, can they freely choose not to do something like this? And if so, how do you achieve the change that Michelle Thompson's asking about?
Three questions to end with. But if you could think of a very succinct response to that, that would be helpful.
Go.
There are bill provisions which make it a requirement on bodies to have regard to the need to promote Gaelic and Scots. And I think that, we are part of a democratic society and the stakeholders in relation to both of these languages will be acting not just for Scottish Government, but they can also act to ensure that these bodies do make positive choices where appropriate, where there are speaker communities, to ensure that action is taken forward. So it's not so much, even just having that awareness of I am about to publish a book, I'm going to do it in lots of languages. We see examples up and down the country where that is done for lots of languages, but not for Gaelic and not for Scots because of maybe a lack of awareness that would be a positive thing to contribute for the language. So having it there as a consideration will hopefully lead to more positive choices.
I'd like to thank you for your time today. We're now going to have a suspension until 10:48 to allow for a change of witnesses. Okay, thank you very much.
Generous and interesting questions. Thank you.
Okay, thank you and welcome back. We are now going to take evidence from our second panel today on the Scottish Languages Bill. Welcome, everyone, and thank you for joining us. I'm going to start by asking our witnesses to introduce themselves and say which organisation they are representing today. So I'll start on the left, at my left, if that's okay.
Okay. Good morning, everybody. I'm Crochor O'Gilligan. I'm the Gaelic research professor, the Gaelic research professor in the University of the Highlands and Islands.
Okay. Good morning. I'm Robert McCall Miller. I'm Professor of Linguistics and Scottish Language at the University of Aberdeen, and I'm here basically representing dictionaries of the Scots language.
Okay, thank you.
Good morning, Matthew Vah. I'm Wilson MacLeod, and I'm Professor Emeritus of Gaelic at the University of Edinburgh.
Thank you.
And good morning. I'm Michael Dempster, and I'm the Director of the Scots Language Centre.
That's great. Thank you very much. Can we move straight to members' questions? And I think first in the second panel is Pam Duncan-Glancy. Thank you, Pam.
Thank you. Thank you, convener. Good morning to you all. And thank you for the information you've submitted in advance. It's really helpful. As you'll be aware, a number of people have raised some concerns about the scope of the bill and the scale of the challenge. So I really just wanted to start with a question that Professor O'Gilligan, you've included in your paper, which is the legislation relevant to the primary issue facing Gaelic speakers in Scotland?
Okay, thank you, Pam, for that. Yes, the basic question about this bill from the Gaelic community is, does it really amount to real reform? Or is it just a change to the existing legislation without dealing with the social challenges that the speakers live with? I don't think it introduces anything new that is going to help the vernacular community in the islands with the linguistic crisis they live with at the minute. Basically, it is a re-bureaucratisation of the existing setup, and the crisis emerged under the existing setup. Therefore, the only way out of the crisis is for radical change, and this bill does not amount to radical change.
Thank you. That was very, very clear. And I think we've also had evidence that indicates what you've said. But specifically, there's one quote we've got that says, the bill as introduced is a cautious and incrementalistic measure that should bring some modest improvement over time. Can I ask the panel, is that good enough?
Do you want to start, Professor? They're all professors. Some I'm going to struggle today.
It's not. There is no point, from a Gaelic point of view again, there's no point in proceeding with this bill as it is. This is a question of going through the motions, enacting new legislation, but not affecting any change. The issue is, does legislation help the community? If not, well, then we're into this realm of pointless legislation, that it introduces minor change without dealing with the situation that's there. It's quite obvious to the average member of the vernacular Gaelic community that the current system, the current approach, isn't dealing with the real-world issues. Therefore, we need real-world legislation that the legislature will help the community to start addressing their social problems. What we have, if we proceed with this bill, what we will have is a framework or a dispensation that is sufficient for Gaelic as a school language and for the symbolic value of Scottish to Scottish identity. It is nowhere sufficient to helping a vernacular community that is struggling to survive. So my suggestion would be to halt the process as it is and redraft the legislation with a view towards addressing the social issues, rather than this emphasis on schools and the symbolic value of Gaelic.
I'm going to move along the panel, because if that's okay.
Yes.
Thank you very much.
Right. Of course, I'm speaking from the Scots point of view here. Now, it is great that finally something is being done for Scots after, you know, hundreds of years of less than wonderful support there. And it's been a building thing. But the issue is, if you declare a language official, what does that actually mean? Because if we look at somewhere like Wales, there are all sorts of guidances to both Welsh and English, because in order to make Welsh official, you had to make English official as well. Okay, Scots, with its however many million speakers, is not an immediate threat of dying out. It's not needing that sort of thing. But a focus just on saying, hey, let's have Tartan Day or something like that, doesn't really get to the bottom of it. There needs to be a degree of funding, and it needs to talk to local speakers and local activists. And I'm not entirely convinced. I support the bill because it is a mammoth step forward for us. But eventually something will have to be done to make it realistic.
Professor McLeod.
I think I used the phrase that it was a cautious and incrementalist bill. It is that. I think it has considerable potential if it can be strengthened in appropriate ways as it goes through Parliament. One of the major weaknesses of the bill is that it doesn't go into enough detail, that it sets up the potential for issuing various sets of standards, guidance, regulations, and so on, but it doesn't tell us much about what these are going to consist of. That's left for another day, and I think much more needs to be spelled out within the bill. A major omission from the bill is really a key demand of the Gaelic community going all the way back to the 1990s. If we look at the Gaelic Act of 2005, the top line demand was a right to Gaelic medium education. And that wasn't put in the bill. It hasn't been put in since. And it's still missing from this bill, an enforceable legal right to Gaelic medium education. Now, exactly the contours of that would need to be specified, but that's not in there. And there are also very significant questions about enforcement. If this goes ahead in its current form, Scotland will be the only part of these islands without a language commissioner. There's a language commissioner in Wales, in the Republic of Ireland, and shortly to be in Northern Ireland, not to mention many other minority language jurisdictions. So it's underfired, underpowered in that sense. But I think the bigger question surrounding all of this is that legislation, the legislative framework, is only one strand, maybe even not the most important strand of Gaelic language policy, that there's a larger infrastructure that's involved of administrative agencies and so on, and especially Gaelic organizations of different kinds. And we really see this erosion of the funding and the support for Gaelic across the board over the last 15 years, affecting the Gaelic board, Borsna Gaelic, affecting the funding for the specific grants for Gaelic education. We see flatline funding for the Gaelic media service. So that over time, the budgets of these organizations have eroded on the scale of about 50%. They're hugely underpowered in terms of what they're able to deliver, and especially in terms of action on the ground in terms of community development, that community development work in Gaelic is hugely underfunded. There's a very strong submission by Cumann na Gaelic, which is the main organization that works on Gaelic community development, and they're really hamstrung by the underfunding of the organization in a serious way, in a growing way. Obviously, the inflation of recent years has been a serious problem there. So I think there are a lot of questions about the implementation of the existing act, about the funding mechanisms, and about the way that this act, this bill, can be strengthened to make it more effective and just better powered to deliver positive outcomes for the Gaelic community. But it does require some thinking, but I think it's very important that the bill be taken forward at this stage.
Mr.
Yep. First off, I'd like to acknowledge the hundreds and hundreds Scots activists that have brought us to the point where Scots is on a bill. With their work, particularly in recent years, that's entirely commendable, the work that's been done. The Act as it stands, coming for nae recognition as Scots, which has got millions of speakers within Scotland and out with Scotland, is deeply significant. The Scots Language Centre and the community that we interact with, we're very keen for the bill to go ahead with us. We we all understand within Scotland, we acquire our knowledge of the sociolinguistic hierarchies within Scotland really quickly and really young, and folk that come to Scotland acquire it really quickly. So we all understand that Scots is the thing that you shouldn't be talking, right? So we're still at that status point of view. So the fact that recognising Scots as an official language is awfully important. Folk need to understand that you can come to the Parliament and you can speak in your own Scots, no matter what dialect you're speaking. You can do it at work, you can do it in education, you can go to the school. We're still at the point where every week at the Scots Language Centre, we're speaking to folk about the physical abuse that they received at school for speaking in their own Scots. And this carries on intergenerationally, where within families, they will prevent the passing on of Scots. They will only talk Scots to Wales. But through miracle of language, Scots is still hale and hearty, the new within Scotland. But what we need to do is interactions with official bodies, with official organisations. We need to start redressing this hierarchy that Scots has rang and Scottish Standard English is right. And we need to redress that. So we really do welcome the recognition of the official use of Scots. I think that's something in terms of a forum that's appropriate. It's something we need to develop. It'll take generations until it actually settles, and we need to develop a form of official Scots. That's something that came out of the Glasgow University research for that. I think with this bill placing the obligation in the ministers to come up with a Scots language plan, that's going to that allows us to start talking about that and understand what forms that's going to take. But in terms of the symbolic allowance that you're allowed to speak Scots within Scottish society is awfully important. Literacy in the second part of the bill that applies to Scots within education, we've seen great advances with the SQA Scots Language Award coming in the Open University course, coming in the new that's training teachers. And these are facilitating a local and a ground-up approach to developing Scots, developing literacy. The Curriculum for Excellence is widely recognised as brilliant about having a literacy defined as communication that is of value to your society. And Scots is included in that, and Scots across the curriculum now is able to come in. But all of this needs support. With the bill in its current form, we've got recommended amendments that we put in our reply here, quite a number of them for each of these, about recognising dialects. I think there's a concern that often people from strong dialect areas and generally assume that the Scots then couldn't earn an official capacity doesn't represent their language. So that's something that kind of needs to be addressed, and I think the inclusion of dialect organisations within the bill is quite important. But I do think we're laying a broth and for Scots going for it and allowing Scots to come out of the house, which is where UNESCO recognises its domain, into the public domain, as was before. So.
There was a lot in there, Dr. Dempster, and I know some of the themes will be picked out later on by other members, so you'll get a chance to expand, so don't worry so much about that. Have you got anything further, Pam?
I have one further question, but it's only one question. I'll keep it short. Thank you, Convener. The Board have said... Thank you for your answers. The Board have said that they don't know that it adequately addresses... It recognises the challenges in the community and that could erode trust and engagement. Are the panel concerned about that? And if so, what do they think we need to do differently to keep the trust and the engagement of the communities?
Question, please.
The board have said have said that the bill fails to adequately address and recognise rather the challenges the community are facing, and that could erode trust. So does the panel agree? And what do they think could be done about that?
I think maybe. Do you want to try responding to that one?
Yes. This will erode trust because it doesn't articulate with reality. We will have more of the aspirations for Gaelic affairs, but there's nothing concrete to help actual communities. Even if we looked from the Gaelic point of view, the biggest change, I've stated already, I don't really believe it's reform. The biggest change is recognising these special areas of linguistic significance. However, when you go into it, there are four designations, one of which relates to the Gaelic communities in the islands, the 20% plus density areas. They are the communities in crisis, and they have to compete now with three other designations. So rather than identifying what the main challenge is, what we've done here, this is a diffuse dispersal of responsibility rather than identifying the main issue. The main issue is, will we have a native-speaking community of Gaelic? The worry with this bill is, this bill could be the legislation by which the remaining communities die out. The research document that goes along with this is telling. There is no reference whatsoever to the most detailed sociolinguistic study of vernacular Gaelic ever conducted, the Gaelic Crisis in the Vernacular Community, published in 2020, and there is no reference to that in the bibliography of that. There is an element now, I think, in the public bodies responsible for Gaelic affairs that are ignoring the community. How can you expect to get traction for legislation when you ignore the actual community of speakers?
Clear it was to say that the board said that if the bill didn't, rather than it wasn't a statement of their opinion on it, it was if the bill doesn't do enough to address. So that was the point. Thank you.
I should say it also for Scots, but in a different way. Michael has already mentioned parts of it, which is that there is a danger that people who are activists at the centre will be perceived as dictating a foreign form. We saw it actually happen in the north of Ireland in the late 1990s, early years, where activists were pushing things in one direction, which local people who were speakers of Ulster Scots couldn't recognise as their own language. Right? Now, I'm not suggesting something quite like that would happen in Scotland, but what I believe strongly in is it has to be built from the bottom up. There are organisations out there, I think you hear just the Shetland Forwards and also the Doric Board in the northeast of Scotland, which can actually speak in the vernacular of that area and have an importance which sometimes is not recognised, because it's much easier to say, let's set something up in Edinburgh or something like that, when in fact, you know, given technology and all now, it's easy to communicate much more so. So I would say that I think you would agree with me on that, that has to build from the community, from the speakers, otherwise it's pointless. And it may actually be dangerous, because all it is that people associate Scots with poets and people that are politically or socially motivated.
Okay.
To come back to the Gaelic side of it, I think that the bill, you know, takes in different kinds of perspectives and very much recognises that the Gaelic community is quite dispersed, has different elements to it, and very important that opportunities are given to develop Gaelic across Scotland as appropriate, and therefore different kinds of Gaelic communities can be promoted and assisted in different ways. And obviously, when we talk about a Gaelic community in Glasgow, we're talking about something very different from a Gaelic community in Barra. But it's very important that we find avenues to assist the promotion of Gaelic in urban contexts, such as especially most notably in Glasgow. So I think this area of the idea of areas of linguistic significance is one that holds potential, as set out in the first version of the bill, is problematic in a few respects. Most obviously, and I think this is one of the issues that Bhosna Gaelic may have been looking to in that statement of concern, is that it sets up a procedure, a system, but gives no real indication of what the outcomes are going to be. What will change on the ground if an area is designated as an area of linguistic significance? If it's a matter of a few more bilingual signs, that's not really going to help. Where that gets complicated is when we start to move into the very complex area of the relationship to wider socioeconomic issues in terms of infrastructure, connectivity, employment, housing, etc., which are obviously very large-scale problems that are affecting all parts of Scotland in many different ways. So it's a tough nut to crack, but there is some sense, I think, definitely that the bill describes a bureaucratic procedure and an administrative system, but gives no indication of what can really change on the ground. That obviously ties into question of funding and so on and so forth. One specific issue that's come through with that is the role that's been proposed for local authorities in designating areas of linguistic significance. And it's not clear why that should be the case. I think, broadly speaking, and it's somewhat simplistic, somewhat unfair, there would be a perception in the Gaelic community, most obviously based on the experience from Gaelic education, that local authorities are generally not supportive of Gaelic. They are not proactive. They are not taking the lead on Gaelic development. And so putting too much in the hands of local authorities is not the best way forward for this. As I say, some authorities might feel that's not a fair characterization, but I think it is a fair assessment of widespread perception in the Gaelic community.
Again, I know we've got questions on that particular theme later on as well, if that's okay. So I want to speak a little bit about what the current policy framework is for Gaelic, so it's more directed at that side of things, and does it have the right balance of focus on the institutions, their Gaelic plans, the school education and the community development? And I'm really interested in, I'm using your language, Professor O'Gilligan, about the doesn't in fact address the real world issues. I suppose that's one of the so what are some of those real world issues that are out of kilter with the current policy framework that exists right now?
At the minute, we have around 60 corporate plans from different civic bodies in Scotland. Some of them are more useful than others. Generally, they tend to emphasize the symbolic value of Gaelic, rather than suggesting any practical support to learners or speakers. What is suggested now is that we move away from the Gaelic language approach, which has been overly bureaucratic and overly symbolic, I think, and we're moving now towards this standard, language standard process. What that will do is that will introduce an even greater bureaucratic burden without actually addressing the issues that are there. Some of the difficulty with this aspect of the bill, moving from language plans to standards, is that this is mimicking ideas that have been developed in other sociolinguistic contexts. For example, this is in Wales and they're talking about this in Ireland. Rather than doing our own original thinking about the Gaelic world, we mimic approaches from other jurisdictions where there is no way that we can have a similar sociolinguistic approach in Scotland than we have in Wales. In Wales, the speaker group is 500,000 people, and they have massive, in comparison to Gaelic or even Irish, they have massive civic support. So unless we root the approach in the actual reality, we're not going to start addressing the issue. It's the standards in the heel of the hunt for such a minoritised language. It's just another bureaucratic approach to an issue that the civic bodies haven't really dealt with from a societal point of view.
Can you comment, Professor McLeod, on the current policy framework and how it's having the right balance? And your perspective?
Well, I think one key element is the weak implementation of the 2005 Act. When the Act was introduced, the policy memorandum for the 2004 bill, as was, said there would be 5 or 10 language plans per year. If that were the case, at that pace of implementation, we'd have between 100 and 200 plans. By now, we have only about 60. Many of the plans are very weak, quite symbolic, you might even argue tokenistic in some places. And that's especially the case in relation to the plans in the stronger Gaelic areas. The key principle of the 2005 Act was that there would be varying levels of provision and plans would be more stringent in Gaelic areas. And unfortunately, the plans that were adopted and approved by the Bosnian Gaelic and by the Scottish Government in relation to stronger Gaelic areas were too weak, in my opinion. Part of that was the problem, and this goes to a wider issue we may come to later about a language commissioner. And Bosnian Gaelic is a small, underfunded public body that has pretty little status and power in the wider public realm in Scotland. It cannot push very hard against public bodies to demand strong language plans, and it doesn't really have the power to enforce them very effectively. A stronger system in which plans are more targeted, more stringent in terms of their requirements, could be much more effective. But to say the weak implementation of the Act has been unfortunate.
Thank you, Professor. Ruth Maguire, supplementary, thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Professor McLeod, you spoke there about a weakness in plans, and particularly in, I'm assuming your island authorities, I'm assuming. Could you give an example of what you mean by that, by a weak move? Because obviously this is, we're not embedded in all this, so it's helpful to know what about it is weak and what needs to be stronger.
Mostly in the nature of service provision, the range of provision, services that can be provided through the means of Gaelic across the full range of services that a local authority or a health board, for example, might provide. And that would be obviously have significant ramifications in terms of recruitment. But just the extent to which the public body plays a role in community life and drives community development of different kinds, that there's taking a lead on that. And we can see very clearly the way that Welsh became embedded in public life in Welsh-speaking areas of Wales, really from the 1970s onwards, in a way that didn't happen in Scotland, even in areas of comparable linguistic density. So I think there was really an expectation, certainly from those of us who studied the bill as it was going through in 2004-05, that we would see significantly greater, stronger plans in Gaelic areas, and that was the assumption or the framework set out in the guidance for the 2005 Act for the Gaelic language plans. And it hasn't really been implemented very effectively. I think that's partly because of caution on the part of Bosnian Gaelic that if they push too hard in demanding stronger Gaelic language plans, they'll lose the goodwill of public authorities that they can't afford to lose, and that the Scottish Government won't back them up if it comes to, should we force this stronger plan on a public body.
Sorry, very brief. We've asked about outcomes and what will success look like, and I suppose listening to you, am I intruding into someone else's? Okay,
Can I move to questions now from Ben McPherson, please? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for your time. You've all touched on this a bit already, but please expand as you see appropriate. But what would success look like in the long term for Gaelic and Scots, respectively, in your view? How should success be measured? And as a point of clarity, given what you've already stated, could you just be clear with the committee whether you think there should be a pause and this bill should be reconsidered, which I think you're arguing, or this bill should be amended? If you could just be very clear individually what your thoughts are on that point. So what would success look like in the long term, and how should it be measured, and your thoughts on the bill?
Okay, well, I start off. Yes, as I've previously stated, and you said that, Ben McPherson, I think the bill should be paused as it is. It's not going to introduce any new beneficial innovation for the Gaelic community. Potentially could actually do harm, that it puts more focus on the bureaucracy when we need a focus on community development for the Gaelic-speaking communities and learners. This, again, has all been set out in the research report, The Gaelic Crisis in the Vernacular Community. There are plenty of suggestions, recommendations, all ignored in this process. I find it frankly baffling that the
those engaged in research and policy advice could contribute to the development of legislative reform and not refer to the evidence, the social evidence of the speakers. What success would look like, to answer your question directly, I would put the emphasis on resource for a community development approach among the Gaelic-speaking communities, and that would entail directly funded resource. It's telling as well also, there is no financial provision for the areas of linguistic significance. So what that is saying to the community, this is extending the symbolic approach of the language plans to the native-speaking vernacular community. The last thing the native speakers of Gaelic need is more symbolic, more of this symbolic approach to Gaelic affairs. What we need is real-world financial support that is rooted in a community development approach to Gaelic affairs and the Gaelic community. That is the big weakness of the 2005 Gaelic Act. It emphasised the symbolic appeal of Gaelic, and it emphasised the symbolic, or as Professor McLeod is saying, the tokenistic use of Gaelic in official bodies. Way too little emphasis on actual speakers and networks of learners. So basically what I'm saying is, pause this act. A complete reappraisal of Gaelic affairs is called for to introduce this community development approach to Gaelic in Scotland.
And next.
Just to get the linguistic side.
Thank you. Yes, well, I think I would very much hope that the Parliament proceeds with the bill at this stage, and I think there's been a number of submissions from Gaelic organisations and across the Gaelic community that would indicate that that would be the desire of the Gaelic community, as expressed publicly, at any rate. It's a very difficult question in terms of, you know, ultimate measures of success. I think we should think in terms very much about outcomes and not outputs. It's easy to point to things that have been produced and so on. Eventually, we're looking to a wider use of Gaelic, more people speaking Gaelic more frequently in more contexts. That's a very high-level goal to achieve, and it's a difficult one to measure when we talk about actual language use. But that we should bear that in mind. I would certainly want to see higher level targets. One of the things, if we look, for example, at the National Language Strategy in Wales, they set high level targets, most obviously the overall number of recorded speakers, but also in terms of numbers enrolling in Welsh medium education and so on and so forth. And then that is rolled out through different kinds of mechanisms. So with regards to Welsh medium education, for example, there's a system of Welsh in education strategic plans that local authorities put together. They are given a target that they've worked with the Welsh government to implement that. It's a binding target. They're really required to move towards that. Similarly, teacher education institutions in Wales, there's a push to setting that 30% of students entering teacher education programs will be going into the Welsh stream, and this is connected to the funding and planning for these teacher education providers. So this kind of systematic planning to achieve high-level targets. I think these are ways we can measure this. I would sound a note of caution, because I'm aware that the results of the 2022 census, is it? It was postponed. The new census results will be coming out for Gaelic quite soon. And I think people outside the world of, you know, language policy or sociolinguistics overinvest in census statistics as an indicator of, a very high level indicator of linguistic vitality. The census is a very crude instrument. It's the most useful thing maybe we have for Gaelic at a wider level, but we have to take it with a real note of caution in terms of what it tells us about actual linguistic vitality. So whichever way the numbers point, but the idea that somehow it's a huge indication of major change is something to be quite concerned about. So I wouldn't invest too much in that. That's certainly the case.
Thank you both.
So in the first instance, to answer your second question, I think the bill should be amended. And that would target some levels of markers of success. One of the main things that we looked at with the Scots Language Centre was the assertion and the incorporation into Scots law of rights, linguistic rights. So a lot of these exist, but they're quite nebulous. But recently, with the incorporation of the Convention of the Rights of the Child, that brings in like 9 articles on linguistic rights. For the rights of the child. I've provided a list, I think, of 9 existing rights legislations. That's one of the main kind of amendments that I think should be brought in. So that would speak to the success of what this bill would achieve. UNESCO identifying that Scots is mainly a hame language, it's in the hoose. What we need is an endogenous movement of that out into general Scottish society, using formal situations. We do have social exclusion and prevention of career progression for Scots speakers. One of the issues that we also mentioned for an amendment is about collecting data. We need a kind of requirement for public bodies to collect data, because largely we rely on extensive stories that are told to the Scots Language Centre and other organisations, and it's very common for folk to be excluded from work, to be excluded from a lot of social situations, and education, higher education and colleges seems to be one that's quite a significant issue. So when it comes to education, the Scots Language Centre, we advocate for a full spectrum of Scots education, for first reception at preschool, right through university. There are aspects of that coming into position there. Where we are currently, just even in terms of English, if you're a speaker of English with a Scots accent, the provision in early years assumes a received pronunciation. So a lot of acquisition of literacy, reading and writing skills is based on rhyme and things like that. And we often, all the resources assume a South England phonology. Now, the Scots accents within Scotland all come from Scots, and they behave quite differently. So it's not even about introducing that. Scots has got a value for English literacy, language acquisition. There are many suspicions that low literacy levels correlate with high Scots speaking. And these kind of aspects. This all needs to be explored. So that would be a marker, actually looking at literacy levels and inclusion and education and progression in education. The Scots Language Centre provides a lot of school classes and things like that, and one of the immediate benefits, and this is in common with the Open University course, is pupils that are excluded tend to be Scots speakers. And as soon as you speak Scots, you've got a lesson in Scots, they become the expert within the classroom, and they become included, and they positively lead and integrate into the classroom, and it can have long-lasting effects, even beyond that Scots lesson, right across the curriculum. So we've got markers like these that are quite nebulous. They're not directly related to Scots, but success of this bill would be full integration and full recognition that the culture of Scotland going back to the 18th century has been about changing our language from Scots to Scottish Standard English. And we still carry that forward, not maliciously, but maybe in an unexamined way. And that's something that I think would be a massive success on this bill.
Right. Yes. From the point of view of Scots, the bill has to go forward. Certainly amended, but from our point of view, there's no question about this. This is our time to do it. When it comes to being asked what do you want? You know, you can move into sort of utopianism. Actually, what I want to say is two things. I agree with Michael, taking it out of the home into the world, that's a good idea. But first, we've got to make sure it's in the home. Right? All these sad stories which I hear regularly about people that brought up their children to be English speakers and solely English speakers and then regret it later on. Because kids pick it up anyway, but not quite in the same way. So from that point of view, the home is important, but so is the school. Now, I'm the son of school teachers and I'm married to a school teacher. So please don't take it in any way that I'm attacking school teachers here, because that would be completely wrong. But there has to be an understanding of how we can go forward which doesn't push against the natural understanding of school teachers that it's just another thing that they've got to tick a box for. Right? And where there's open antipathy sometimes about it as well. Many years ago when I was young and stupid, rather than older and stupid as I am now, I wrote something which suggested that teachers who went through Scots courses, if they couldn't speak Scots, would pay less tax because they do similar things in Norway for that sort of thing. Right? Sorry?
About progressive taxation. Anyway, carry on.
Well, yes, I'm in favour of that as well, but that's another matter. But what I was talking about was the sense that teachers should feel empowered and also be willing to do this. The school and the home are the two things where, if we don't watch ourselves, things will go. And we've seen it happen already. Yes, we have loads of speakers, but where are the Scots speakers of the Black Isle? They died out in 2012. You know, so there were other reasons for that, the fishing community going and so on. But the primary one was that. So in the future, I would like to see a situation where, with a very small amount of funding, actually, you can make a difference about this in encouraging people to carry it on in new ways. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Mr. McPherson. Can I come now to Liam Kerr, please?
Yeah, thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. A brief question to begin, actually, to Professor O'Gilligan. If we assume that the government won't pause this bill, as you suggested, we've had representations that it might be better to have two separate bills, one relating to Gaelic, one relating to Scots. Is that a useful suggestion in your view, and should the government be considering it?
Because of the difficulties in the... with relation to the Gaelic community or Gaelic affairs, we don't want that holding up any progress for Scots. So if that means proceeding with the Scots aspect of the legislation, fair enough. But the logic of your question is, in that context, we'd have to split the Gaelic provisions from the Scots provisions and draft a new bill. It essentially mean reform of the 2005 Act. That would be much preferable than proceeding with this inadequate and incomplete legislation as we have at the minute.
Thank you. Professor Miller, you talked earlier on, very interestingly, about dialects and vernacular. This bill talks of the Scots language. But people are, I think, going to be confused by that. The Scots language appears to refer to one particular dialect. The bill team would suggest that it had suggested this morning it incorporates the Doric, the Orkney Norn, the Lallans. But those dialects would use fundamentally different words to Scots language, which perhaps Dr. Dempster has been using this morning. Is this then the right framing to call it the Scots language? Is it clear enough in your view? And what are the implications if not?
Okay, it's a good question which is often asked. And indeed, the Scots Language Centre for the 2011 census did incredible things to build up the sense of similarity there actually are between the dialects. Now, if you look at somewhere like Norway, where I've lived, they have two standard varieties of the same language, but people are encouraged to speak their own dialects of that, within that. So there is a sense, oh yes, you come from Taylor Mark, oh yes, you come from Finnmark, and so on. But there's no sense of it being not Norwegian about that. That's centuries of neglect that have caused that. It's not, that would have to be worked on. But if people want to call their language Doric, if people want to call it Shetland or whatever, that's fine, right? As long as we all understand that there's an overreaching sense, not a standard variety. We're not there yet. I don't know when we would be there yet. But let's say you're a speaker of an unusual, slightly different dialect of a Nilotic language spoken perhaps in Uganda or something like that. Now, at some levels, you say, oh, I speak this small-scale identity, and that would be true. But in other ways, you're aware of the connections there. Now, yes, certainly, Shetland in particular is highly distinctive. But to be honest with you, a lot of that is sociolinguistic. It's not linguistic. Not really. There are differences, but that's the issue there. So that's why I was saying from the bottom up. People should be empowered in their local varieties of speech, which are varieties of Scots, just like Dorset English and Lancashire English are all English. Right? Nobody says then, isn't that a problem that people are being taught standard English? Because shouldn't we write Dorset? We're not at that stage. We shouldn't be, in my view, at that stage there, because it's about democracy. But on the other hand, if we call ourselves some kind of collective of different dialects, it really doesn't make us very strong. It's an easy way to pick one off one at a time there. If people, you know, who are speakers of these dialects don't agree with that viewpoint, that is their right. They would still get funding and encouragement. But the point is that there would be a connection between the different parts of Scotland, which has never been encouraged in the past.
But if that's correct, then how does a Scots language strategy imposed from the top adequately allow for the different versions of the Scots language to thrive?
Good question, and that's why I'm pushing for the idea that it's from the top in the sense that it has to be funded from somewhere, right? There are actually local funds coming in at other ways as well, in different ways. For instance, Moray Council, Angus Council, Shetland Council do a lot for the local language use because they think it's a good thing to do, right? When it comes to below that, below this idea of funding, then surely there has to be some way in which there is articulation of different views and different dialects. This is commonplace practically everywhere apart from anywhere that speaks English.
First off, I'd say that I'm not speaking a Stonor Scots that would be imposed across or the dialects. That's not something that I don't think I'd represent myself or anybody would represent this as being the Stonor Scots. I think one of our recommended amendments is the word and the use of being replaced with speaking and writing and spoken and written. We have written traditions, and the written dialect traditions can often present a greater difference between dialects than the spoken forms do. And one of the things with internet communication and greater integration is folk are realising that most of their lexis is the same across dialects, and the commonality is coming back in. Now, historically, there was an identity that Scots was what was spoke quite widely. In the northeast, we often get older folks saying, "Oh, it's no Doric we speak; it's northeast Scots." Right? So this identity exists historically, and it currently exists. So it's about encouraging the local dialects to come together. And fund these commonalities, and often encouraging that, you discover that the written form comes towards a Scots that's acceptable to pan-dialectically as well. But that's not necessarily, we didn't need one forum. There is maybe, the only argument I can see for that is an official form of Scots, so anything that's coming out of the Parliament or the councils would maybe gravitate towards a form, and that's happened worldwide historically. Other languages, But I think one of the strengths of the Scots strategy is we can bring together dialects and we can actually see what is in common. Where do we work for here? How does the Shetland speaker speak with the Dumfries speaker? What's in common there? So superti is about approaching a written form that's acceptable, but there's high mutual intelligibility between Shetland and Dumfries and Galloway. That mutual intelligibility is there, and when you get folks speaking together in a room, they realise that, and they suddenly, we all interact with our language in a dialect forum, but suddenly when you get folk together in a room, which we hope to do off the back of this bill, folk realise the commonality and they twig why this is a language, why linguists recognise it as a language for their area, Scots. So.
I'm very grateful. Thank you. Convener.
Thank you. My role as convener is to always have an eye on the clock. So if I was wondering if the panel could try and keep their responses as succinct as possible, that would be helpful as we move to questions from Stephanie Callaghan now, please. Thank you.
Thanks very much, convener. If I could just stay with you there, Michael, for a minute as well there. You're talking about having that kind of agreed written form of Scots. And I'm wondering how realistic that is when Doric, for example, can be so different from where I come from in Lanarkshire. So I remember going up and staying with my friend's family up in Aberdeen over the summer holidays and my mum phoning up and not being able to understand a word that was said. So I'm wondering, how is it that we actually get back to that then?
There's a number of solutions to pan-dialectical forums. So there's things like a lot of the dialect writing are using the tools of standard English to represent their dialects. So in the North East, you'd prefer an F for the whiz and fit than what. The UI spelling is one that comes up all the time because that kind of geographically, kind of, so like moon or school, the skill versus the squeal. So these orthographic forums, you can either have. You need to learn them, right? In English, we all learn that O-U-G-H is pronounced off O, or not pronounced at all, right? There's a variety of this. You need to learn it, and that's what becomes part of the education process. And one of the things, working with teachers in the Open University, is through this commonality, we recognise these historical forms, because these are spelling conventions that we recognise historically. It was about the 1960s that folks started abandoning these to go into strong representations of that. So just in terms of the written form with that, these solutions are there, but folk need to learn them. Folk need to learn the silent letters. Folk need to learn that it works slightly different, the way that French spelling works different, that kind of thing. So are they solutions? And in terms of spoken language, it's just increasing communication and public representation. So folk...
If somebody from Scotland meets somebody from, say, the deep south of the United States, it takes a while to follow each other, but nobody says, my God, that must be a different language. It's about education that goes in with that. And in fact, it's also that thing that we all do with our native languages, which is you click and you go, oh, right. But they do, when I do that, they do that. It's quite natural, all speakers do that. So a certain pride can be taken in not understanding somebody. You know, and sometimes it's difficult. I have to say, when the first time I heard Shetland, I was like, oh, because I'd never heard it before. That's the thing. You know, I've heard plenty of people from the northeast of Scotland before I moved there. I've never heard a Shetlander. Not really. So from that point of view, it isn't easy. Nobody's fooling themselves about that, but it is eminently doable, particularly in a situation where children are exposed to other dialects at an early age at school.
I'd be quite interested. I'll just wind my education question.
The substantive themes that we were looking for, please.
Well. When you're talking about that there, then, is it about, you know, if we're talking about in the classroom and in our schools, is it about children learning about the different dialects from across Scotland as well then, and having that wider understanding? And Robert, you mentioned earlier on about teachers being empowered as well. And is that kind of partly about history and locations and place names and stuff and embedding it in that kind of way? Is that what you're talking about, Robert?
Sort of, but the problem with that is it doesn't seem to be actual now. I think there has to be both there. But the problem is that quite often academics, including people that I think very highly of, come in and talk about the glory days of Scotland before the collapse and Scots being the national language, you know, the official language, rather, of the country, and so on in the 15th, 16th century. That's great, but it doesn't butter bread. Whereas being able to understand somebody from roundabout Stranraer, which I find quite difficult, I have to say, is a very important thing and is good for the economy and things like that. So it's just about there. In Norway, they have dialect tolerance classes where you listen to other dialects. Because it's a mountainous country and all that, the dialects are very different from each other over quite small areas. And I wish I'd done them when I lived there. You know, because you'd come out of a tunnel, an 11-kilometre-long tunnel, and discover that no, you couldn't understand a word of what anybody said, at least to begin with. We don't have that problem. Most Scots speakers are in a continuum. You know?
I'd also say there is a concern for one of the reasons we suggest having dialect organisations in here, is that there's a concern for folk that perceive themselves as being minority dialects of Scots having dialect levelling, where their variety will be replaced with that. And I think by including and strengthening the dialects and having imposing for the top down a system that allows a bottom-up preservation of the dialect and what's important locally to folk in their own forms, I think that's something that could be integrated with this bill, with the recognition of dialect organisations.
Bill Kidd now, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thanks, panel. To what, if any degree, has the policy in Scotland about language been led by the principles and provisions of the European Charter for Regional or Minority Languages, which I've never heard of before, so I hope you have.
Well, maybe we could break that down into two parts, because the European Charter for Regional Minority Languages is an international treaty of the Council of Europe, so it's nothing to do with the European Union. The UK has been ratified the charter in 2001, and Gaelic is one of several languages, including Manx and Cornish, that are covered by this charter. But the level of provision, the level of requirements for different languages varies significantly. And in particular, there's a difference between what we call Part 2 and Part 3 of the Charter. Part 3 is more stringent and has sort of binding specific and binding requirements. And Gaelic is covered by Part 3. Scots is only covered by Part 2, which is more general and aspirational to some extent. On the Gaelic side of it, it's been implemented fairly well. The governments, when they ratify the European Charter, have a degree of latitude in terms of deciding exactly what they're going to commit themselves. And either through aspiration or oversight, the UK government actually committed itself to the most stringent requirements in relation to Gaelic. And therefore, the Council of Europe has pulled up the UK for not really implementing the Charter fully in relation to Gaelic education as well as it should have. But to go to the heart of your question, to be quite honest with you, the European Charter is not really a significant factor in Gaelic language policy. The issues and the challenges we're facing don't really, the Charter doesn't really come into play to a great deal. So yes, technically it's true to say the UK government has not completely and 100% complied with its obligations as fully as it might have. That's relatively minor non-compliance, and it's not really significant for the quite considerable challenges that we do face in relation to Gaelic education.
Well, I speak to that. I keep contact with the Council of Europe on that charter and also the Framework Convention for the Protection of National Minorities, which also deals with languages as well. In terms of Scots, of course, we've got such a dearth of reporting, and one of the things we welcome with this bill is that we will have this report and this feedback on what's going on. It is quite a useful tool for examining how Scots is performing within Scotland. So we feedback to that. The Scots Language Centre coordinates across multiple agencies to provide feedback to the Council of Europe on this. They do make recommendations. and often the recommendations is that the Scottish Government and the councils and the UK Government are not meeting the expectations for the previous report. But it's useful in terms of us having a place to report. There's also, as Wilson said about the PERTs, there's universal calling for Scots to be recognised under PERT 3 of the Convention. Specifically, it allows for an area of focus, and specifically it would be education, and that's what everybody's expressing for that. There's no an organisation that doesn't want that. And as Wilson says, that's more stringent, but that would allow us to set out targets for that would be required to, well, there would be a requirement for targets, specific targets, to be implemented instead of, at the minute, it's kind of just like how Scott's doing. That's the kind of question. How's it doing generally, you know, but if we could have targets, that would be useful for education.
Okay, thank you. Thank you.
Earlier in our panel one this morning, we heard around the reversal of language, international success and that sort of reversal of language shift. I don't know if that's the right word. I'm sure you understand. And the panel spoke specifically about French in the context of Canada in terms of that revival. And we've heard a little bit from yourself, Professor Miller, there about some of the things going on in Norway. So are there examples, other examples where international or there's been successful reversal of language shift that maybe the Scottish Government should have been taken cognizance of, and where we might learn lessons in terms of how we could see that reversal reversed in Scotland? I'm getting a bit stumbled on my words there. I'm really apologies for that.
Again, there are examples from other minority language contexts, but everything is contextual in the end. There are millions of speakers of French, which is a minority language in Canada, but it has a very large population, and it has, in one province in particular, it has over 90% social density. So basically what that community needs are civic bodies with conviction and good politics. On the other hand, Scottish Gaelic is a very small minoritized language. So it can only learn from contexts that are in a similar situation. And the closest language is Irish in Ireland, which has had language planning and official policy for over 100 years now at this stage. And we're running into the same difficulty there. The vernacular group in Ireland, after 100 years of language planning, is now around 20,000 people. Our research has indicated that the vernacular community in Scotland is around 11,000 people. What we need are support provisions that deal with the level of minoritisation. And the only way out of that is to increase the agency that the community has in their own context. Borrowing something, there's very ambitious language planning in the Basque regions, in both in the two states, France and Canada. But again, that's a community of 500,000 speakers. So it's about engineering or designing a policy that is fit for purpose. That is the challenge we have here. Emphasise the agency of the community, not the aspiration of the top-down approach which we've had from the 2005 Act.
Thank you for interpreting my very bumbled question there. Does anyone else want to respond to that?
Scots, of course, isn't under threat in the same sense, although it's under threat in the sense of being, how do you put it, dialectalised under English. Right, to use Heinz Kloss's term. What we are comparable, not to Quebec, that would be the wrong way to put it, but to Catalonia and as a situation where since some degree of democracy returned in 1977 in Spain, Catalonia has been able to make its own language policy. There are inducements to learning Catalan, because the problem is that many working class people in Barcelona actually speak Castilian Spanish or a close relative of it, because for a variety of reasons, being internal migrants. So we get this situation where Catalan has been pushed. It's a rich territory. it can dictate its own language policy, although always with this thing that the Spanish constitution says that Castilian Spanish is the language of Spain. So Catalan is the regional language, if that's the right word. But we also have to compare it with places like the northern parts of Germany, where Low German is spoken. Historically, a very important language spoken in Edinburgh by large numbers of people 500 years ago, but is now the language of the countryside and of the elderly and so on. And it's not through any ill will. Germany is very good at supporting its local minorities. It's just because it's not been given enough support in terms of schools and so on. You know, so you can listen to it on the radio, but you couldn't actually learn it at school. That sort of thing. So these other models are often happier models, except when you go looking for all the ones where it didn't work or it didn't happen.
And then, if you don't mind, I'll move on to some next questions from Willie Rennie, please, if that's OK. Thank you.
So we've talked about agency in communities, but doesn't the area of linguistic significance give the potential for that to happen? What would you think, Professor?
The bill per se doesn't really create that kind of mechanism. It really doesn't say anything about community agencies. It talks about a community agency generally, or about community organizations. It talks about local authorities having an important role. It refers to public bodies having additional obligations in areas of linguistic significance, and the witnesses from the Scottish Government this morning spoke about embedding obligations in standards and so on and so forth. But it doesn't create a mechanism for community-driven activity and the funding, perhaps, that would make that possible. To some extent, this proposal bears similarity to the legislation that was brought in Ireland in 2012, the Gaeltacht Act of 2012, which creates language planning areas, but that very much depends on local organizations, typically voluntary organizations of some kind, to drive the process forward. And I think there are critiques of that process, but it is more obviously something that has a community element to it, whereas the proposal as set out in the bill as we see it is quite institutional, and it particularly has a high-level role for local authorities, which is to some extent kind of come out of nowhere in terms of the language planning framework for Gaelic, because local authorities haven't really had a key role in strategic planning for Gaelic up to now. So it's not that obvious on the face of the bill.
Yes, the bill only creates the symbolism of a designation. It's meaningless from a strategic point of view. It doesn't identify organization, doesn't identify responsibility. It doesn't establish a fund, and therefore there's no direction on what processes they're going to follow. I would point out that the 2012 Gaeltacht Act in Ireland, that received very, very little traction beyond state salary holders. So that has not worked as a language planning approach. Again, be very wary of borrowing from other contexts without doing our own thinking about the specifics of the need here. The Gaelic vernacular group is even more minoritized than the Irish native speaking group in the Gaeltacht regions, mostly in the west of Ireland. So the simple answer to answer your question, Willie Rennie, is that all we're going to do is talk about the symbolism of Gaelic affairs with the vernacular communities, rather than giving them agency and developing some mechanisms for empowering themselves in their own context.
But if the bill is to proceed, and I suspect the government is quite keen to proceed, would amendments along the lines that you've just outlined about giving agency, local organisations being empowered with the appropriate funding, would that be something that would give communities agency in the way that you described?
That aspect could be recovered. I'd also say that it's overcomplicated. There are not four designations, there's an element of reductio ad absurdum there. There are two designations. Basically, what we have are the remaining vernacular communities and then the other networks of learners and speakers in other parts of Scotland. What I would do is emphasise those two contexts and then make it clear what resource is available. However, we talked earlier about the crisis in the native speaking community. I think the onus now is on the legislature to admit that we have a crisis and to give priority to dealing with that issue. There's a risible element in the Act that the areas with the designation of over 20% of Irish or of Gaelic speakers, they have to compete with areas where there is a historical interest. So that means areas with little or no Gaelic speakers. So this is the opposite of giving priority to the crisis at the minute. If there is a direct recognition of the crisis, then we develop a strategy and we indicate a stream of resource that is going to help with this empowerment. Well, then the bill can be rectified, I think, or rescued.
Do you have anything further to say? Or you?
Well, I don't agree with much of what Professor Gilligan has set out there. I think it's quite an unhelpful analysis of the situation. I would flag up one issue specifically about the 20% designation. This came out of the Short Life Working Group on Gaelic that was commissioned by Kate Forbes, chaired by Art Cormack. It's a very low designation. 20% is a very low threshold, bearing in mind that includes people who can only understand Gaelic. And in previous research, it's been suggested that a density of 45% might be the minimum that makes it should be operational, or indeed, in some cases, 67 or 70%. So when we talk about a 20% threshold, this includes areas that actually have very limited use of Gaelic in the day-to-day community, but has the potential. We have to harness what the potential is for Gaelic in different parts of Scotland, and I think it would be very unwise to sort of write off the potential that we have for growth. That was actually one of the interesting amendments in the 2005 Act, is that that Gaelic plans and Gaelic planning should take into account the potential for growth, the potential for revitalization. And we certainly see that in places like Glasgow. There are huge problems in harnessing that, huge problems in terms of providing context for social use in these kinds of urban communities. But it's an important part of the challenge and very significant that that element be taken into account in the legislation and wider Gaelic language policy.
Okay, thank you. Ruth, you have a...
You
can move on to...
Is it me anyway?
Yeah, sure.
No, my sup was about whether there were alternative views to that, the perspective put across by... O'Gilligan there, and we heard one. I'm going to ask about Gaelic development and Gaelic learner education and Gaelic medium education. Notwithstanding comments before about school language and symbolism, I think Gaelic medium education is very important. I'd be interested to hear reflections on current kind of strengths and weaknesses. We've spoken before about the challenges around staffing. I don't know if that's included in it, but happy to hear from Professor McLeod or Professor O'Gilligan, whoever.
Well, I think there's a range of different issues. And I'll break it down between Gaelic medium and education and Gaelic learner education, because that's the conventional distinction. We've seen fairly good growth in Gaelic medium education over the last 20 years since the bill was brought in. But I think most people involved in Gaelic education looking at things 20 years ago would have thought we'd be a fair way ahead of where we are now. And there are reasons for that. I think two key reasons would be that relatively few local authorities have started adding Gaelic medium education as part of their provision. That's picked up a bit in just in the last few years. But I was really quite taken aback, but it became institutionalized that Gaelic language plans were being approved for local authorities that didn't make any provision for them to start delivering Gaelic education. So we've got several local authorities that have Gaelic language plans. They might be on their second Gaelic language plan, and they're still not offering Gaelic in any of their schools. I find that just a bizarre position. So a real lack of initiative and energy on the part of many local authorities to drive forward the development of Gaelic education. And then the more specific issue of developing Gaelic schools, dedicated Gaelic schools, and this has really been highlighted as an area where a dedicated school provides a much better immersion environment, a language acquisition environment. And it's been really difficult to get these schools underway. Glasgow has a pretty good record of opening new schools. They're moving to open their fourth primary school, as well as the secondary, which has been in place since 2006. But outside Glasgow, I think you'd struggle to find an authority that's been really proactive. Here in Edinburgh, it was a mighty fight to get a Gaelic school started. It took, to my mind, an unreasonable amount of community organisation and political pressure to persuade the council to open a Gaelic school, which eventually happened in 2013. Highland Council, very slow to develop its Gaelic schools. A huge amount of foot dragging. There's a controversy just now about Argyll and Bute. Very slow and reluctant to develop a Gaelic school and open, despite a very clear evidence of parental demand for that. So that's all been happening on the Gaelic medium education front. On the Gaelic learner side, very little growth. Sorry.
Just to interrupt briefly, I maybe should say that my children went to Scotland, Glasgow. do you have any insight as to what those challenges are about? I mean, certainly reflections from Glasgow were that there was a large groundswell in an existing Highland community which helped. Is that simply, was it that? Because it's not a political thing. These are all different local authorities of different colours, if you like. So it doesn't seem to be party political, or what's your reflection on what might be the issue?
Well, I think that a lot of authorities elsewhere they've just not been proactive. So the 2016 Act created a mechanism by which parents could request a Gaelic medium. It's quite a cumbersome, slow system, very bureaucratic, difficult for parents of young children to negotiate. But that's the only way that local authorities in recent years have started adding Gaelic medium education, is by pushing parents to organise themselves and push through this bureaucratic thicket to get the provision. We don't see any leadership from local authorities in developing Gaelic medium education off their own bat. And so we still have large authorities such as Dundee, Aberdeen, and so on, Aberdeenshire, that don't offer any Gaelic education at all. So anyway, on the Gaelic learner side, we have very, very limited provision, very patchy provision, both at secondary level. So even in places like Glasgow and Edinburgh, with very extensive Gaelic medium provision, don't offer Gaelic learner education in their schools. So either your parents choose Gaelic education for you at age 5 or 4.5, or you are locked out of Gaelic education through the statutory education system. It's a very weird layout of provision. And for primary schools, we have this very unfortunate situation that we've had approximately a 50% drop in the level of provision for Gaelic learner education in primary schools in recent years, because local authorities have dropped existing provision in their schools, in many cases. It's part of the implementation of the 1+2 strategy that for Gaelic went very badly wrong. And yet these are local authorities that have Gaelic language plans. They have Gaelic language plans, and yet the outcome has been that they remove Gaelic from their schools. I find that very strange.
Professor Gilligan, I wonder if I could ask...
And the clock here.
If you could reflect on the... native communities, because we've kind of covered the...
Yes, the two... Well, it pertains to all of Scotland, where we have GME. The two big issues, one is educational, the challenges of progression from the primary level into secondary level, that we're losing a lot of numbers. And then the second issue is linguistic. Even for those who progress to secondary level, and if they're living at S4, 5 or 6... there's a question there to what level have they achieved linguistic fluency, the functional. how fluent are they in conversing with fluent speakers? That's an issue that we don't really address, honestly, and that should be tackled also, I think.
Just to come back briefly, I mean, part of that issue is maybe around wider community use and ability. Not everyone who goes to the Gaelic medium schools will have parents speaking at home. Is that about that wider opportunity?
Yes, there's three issues. There's obviously pedagogy, and then there's the young being socialised into speaking it among their own peer group, and then there's the support from the wider community. And they all have to work together to produce functional fluent speakers. And we're not tying up these different aspects of Gaelic development properly, I think.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Bill Kidd, back to yourself again.
Thank you very much, Convener. Can I ask on a view on the Bord na Gaelic as envisaged in the bill, and on the back of that, in order to widen things out a wee bit there and give everybody a shot, who should lead policy on that basis in relation to the Scots language?
First, Dr. Dempster.
I'll go first. Aye. Yes. So throughout the process, the consultation process of this, the Scots Language Centre is the only organisation that's got a Scotland-wide remit for responsibility for Scots. We work really closely with a lot of partners in Education Scotland, the Open University, the SQA. We also we run the Scots Language Resource Network, which is a resource for all public bodies to come together and make sure we're not getting duplication and inform everybody about best practice within Scots. So we have that. We have the engagement with the Council of Europe, with yourselves, with the British Irish Council, with the Westminster. So we are functioning as this coordinating board. Now, there are fears for dialect areas to do with dialect levelling that a central board would be about wiping out dialect organisations. But the Scots Language Centre works for grown up and bringing in everybody's voices. It's about Scots in all its forms. So our working practice isn't about a top-down kind of approach. We bring folk together for conversations, we share practice and things like that. So in terms of the ecology of Scots language, the Scots Language Centre is in a position to take that, and it might not take the form that Bord na Gaelic would take or other language bodies in the UK or worldwide, but certainly as a coordinating organisation, the Scots Language Centre performs that function. We are stretched to the absolute limit. We budget £90,000 a year, formerly it was £60,000 a year, performing often to the expectations of an organisation that would be funded to the order of £5 million. So we're kind of set up to fail in that kind of way, but we have the knowledge and experience and community connection and community respect, as I understand with all the responses to the consultation, to take that role with appropriate funding. We're for response to the finance invitation for the finance response. We identified basically, it looks like, in the finance, every role that organisations out with the ministerial group would take has been assigned to an organisation that's already funded. So that's the Scots Language Centre. But it's been presented as a zero cost for that, the Scots Language Centre.
Specific questions around the financial memorandum later, Dr. Dempster.
So. Okay, aye. So, but in terms of the ecology of how Scots is working, myself, for the past 5-6 years, I've worked with contacts with everybody involved with Scots, and we have really strong working groups that we've brought together. So I think it's something we can develop with appropriate support.
With Scots and then move to Gaelic, is that okay?
Yeah, I agree with Michael that we have to go with what we have. I mean, I personally, again, talking in idealistic terms, would like to see, again, what happens in Norway and in various other countries where you have local language committees which elect up into regional ones which elect up. So everybody is represented at some level or another. I also have to say that something like this has to exist. Otherwise, why are we bothering saying something's official? You know, it's important that it's official, but we have to do something to show that it has, if not necessarily teeth, at least it can shout about things. and so on, an official body which is built by the people. Surely, that's it. Michael has said it all.
Okay.
Professor McCullough. In relation to Borsna Gaelic, obviously it's a much more developed structure than for anything with regard to Scots. So the bill as proposed takes away some important functions from Borsna Gaelic and assigns them to the Scottish Government. One of them is to develop a national Gaelic strategy, which has previously been in the hands of the Borsna Gaelic National Gaelic Language Plan, and also to take responsibility for the statutory guidance on Gaelic education. And I think both of those are welcome because, as I mentioned earlier, I think the Borsna Gaelic is a small and weak player in the constellation of Scottish public life and doesn't have the stature that the Scottish Government does to really make sure that a national strategy is taken seriously by a wide range of actors and leads to meaningful implementation. So I think there's much better potential there. And that's the much more common pattern internationally, that sort of high-level national strategies are the responsibility of the central government. So that's a good thing, I think. And the same is true with regard to the education guidance, that the existing guidance has been in effect for several years now, but there's certainly concern that it hasn't been implemented vigorously enough. A lot of local authorities aren't really implementing as they really should, and that comes through in some of the inspectorate reports as well as perspectives from Gaelic organisations. But partly that, again, because it doesn't have the weight that something issued by the government itself would have. So this sort of raises the question of, you know, what is Borsna Gaelic's role? It's shrinking to some extent. I think those areas are helpful. But we still have this problem that Borsna Gaelic plays dual roles, that it works with public authorities to shape language plans, it advises them, gives them guidance, and that's clearly part of their statutory functions and obligations. And then it's got to assist them in the monitoring them and so on, but then it's got to turn around and implement them. It's got to play sort of social worker and then police officer at the end of it. And it allows for a tension there. And certainly we can see, in my view, that plans haven't been implemented vigorously enough, and when there have been lapses, that it hasn't led to required compliance. And that's where we get to the issue of a commissioner. We're going to talk about that now, but the possibility of a language commissioner, a different role with the responsibility for enforcement. Language commissioners have become quite common in different jurisdictions around the world. There's at least a dozen of them, an international association of language commissioners. As I mentioned earlier, Wales, Republic of Ireland, and Northern Ireland have a language commissioner. And this could serve for a mechanism for better enforcement and better representation of the rights of the community and the voice of the community, rather than having it subsumed in an organization that's part of the, if you like, bureaucratic matrix.
Thank you. Professor?
I read with interest the analysis of Borsna Gaelic of the proposed bill, and it's actually quite critical. And that's worrying to the extent that the chief civic agency, Borsna Gaelic, charged with Gaelic affairs, is very critical of those who've been charged with drafting policy and legislation for Gaelic affairs. So there seems to be a tension, a disconnect now between the civic body for Gaelic affairs and those drafting the legislation. And that should be particularly worrying for MSPs, that the body in charge of Gaelic affairs is critical of what has been suggested here. There is some breakdown in communication about Gaelic affairs from my reading of their analysis of the situation.
Thank you. Ross Greer, can I?
Thanks. Convener, excuse me. I'd just like to start, just a small question for yourself, Professor Gilligan, going back to what you said previously and your position on the bill overall, and just to seek a little bit of clarity, because it felt to me like what you're essentially saying is, rather than the provisions in this bill, what's really required is significant additional resource to deal with the wider challenges faced by the speaking community in particular. I just want to press you a little bit on that in the context that, you know, this committee have just completed an inquiry into supporting children with additional support needs in schools. Clearly, vast additional resources there would do a lot of good, but we, you know, completed our report, the recognition that's unlikely. Scottish public finances are in a very difficult space, whether you blame that on inflation, the UK government, the Scottish government overcommitting on social security, whatever you think the cause is, significant additional resources in any area of public spending are really unlikely in the coming years. So I suppose my question to you is, given that, and I accept additional resources would be transformational, but if they are unlikely, is there a bill, are there a set of legislative changes, not changes, increases to resources, that you think would actually result in the kind of transformational change that's required?
Thank you. That's actually a very good and very relevant question. Thank you for that. Basically, what's happened is that the symbolic approach to Gaelic policy has run its course. We've got what we're going to get from that, basically. I think we need extra resource. If we're going to spend extra resource, we need a new strategy, and then we need an organisation that is led by community members to develop that strategy. But I would put the emphasis on new resource. However, because we've seen the symbolic approach running its course, Bord na Gaelic, at the minute, is spending the majority of its resources on the language plan approach of these 60 bodies we've been talking about. Well, we could transfer that budget from the symbolic Gaelic plan approach to a community development approach that would help both community speakers and learners. It would be a much better use of resource. However, I think all languages need some type of symbolic backup. I would go for the approach of increasing the budget. Relatively speaking, where we have officially recognised minority languages, states spend much more money on their minority languages than in the Scottish context. So I would go for more resource. Thank you.
Thanks, Arch. That was useful. Wider question I've got for the panel as a whole. You've touched already quite a bit on the language standards and to some extent on education standards, but I'm interested in if anybody has further comments to make on education standards and the corresponding duties that they would place on public bodies. Bear in mind what has already been said about this tension between whether the core challenge here is actually about GME in particular, or wider societal challenges facing the community. So just if there's further comments on education standards in particular, that would be useful.
There's a section in the policy memorandum which I felt was rather unhelpful, that it says that the government had prepared a number of amendments to deal with various operational issues, but it decided to essentially defer those to the standards, and it would be very helpful to get those out into the bill and for public debate and then embedded in the legislation rather than the standards. Perhaps the most pressing of those is the issue of dedicated Gaelic schools. I mentioned that this has been a big issue in relation to Gaelic over the last 20 years. You know, what are the criteria for determining there should be a Gaelic school? I'm not picking a number arbitrarily here, but this is for the sake of argument. If there are 100 pupils in an urban area who want a Gaelic school, that the council would have a legal obligation to open a dedicated Gaelic school. A numerical criterion that would establish, and then some kind of mechanism for driving that process forward, that could be embedded in the legislation rather than the standards. I think the problem is that if everything is embedded in the standards, you don't have the opportunity for discussion. We can have public consultation or something, but it's not the same thing. I personally find it difficult to differentiate between what is contemplated for standards or regulations or as guidance. There's different terms that are used for different kinds of regulatory mechanisms, and that seems unduly complicated.
That is an interesting point. Can I press you on it a little bit, though? Because I suppose the alternative position would be that the more detail that's put into legislation, the less flexibility there is further down the line. So if the context changes rapidly 5-10 years from now, whether it gets better, worse, or just different, it's much harder to change primary legislation than standards and guidance, even if they're underpinned by secondary legislation. So I'm wondering, is your core point of tension here that we simply don't know what the standards and guidance would be, and that if we had drafts published alongside the bill, that might address some of these concerns? Or is it that actually fundamental you think some of these points do need to be in the primary legislation because they're very unlikely to change?
I think
high-level ones that, you know, would be very useful would be a clear legal right to Gaelic medium education, and then clear framework for what is required for setting up a Gaelic school, and to make it that those would be binding. Other things might be, as you say, too specific and too constrictive for long-term primary legislation.
Scots experts have position on education standards in particular?
Yeah, I think in this legislation we've identified within the bill is school education rather than education in general. There are folk at colleges, core skills in colleges. I get a lot of people contacting me saying these are Scots speakers, but we're not even allowed to identify that. So I think even primary legislation, something stating we recognise that Scots is the first language of a significant number of folk in education. I think that, again, it's going back to assertion of rights. I think in schools, linguistic rights should be provided to educators. And I think also public bodies, that should be communicated throughout the public body. So whether I think it's more important to say that Scots is allowed and work and recognised as a skill, because in terms of the numbers, other minoritised languages are incredibly jealous of the numbers we've got in Scots, but they're amazed at how little has been done for it. So I think public bodies and education allowing folk their rights, knowledge of their rights, I think, is something that could go in primary legislation, a requirement of that, and also recognising it within education. But I think education, to allow us to speak to nurseries, schools, colleges, universities, where particularly universities, Scots is used as an exclusionary a function to exclude people for their education and socialising within university. Robert, if you could.
Just very briefly, in answer to that, my wife's from Luxembourg, and in Luxembourg there are three official languages. Luxembourgish, the local native language, there is guaranteed at least an afternoon every week in school, which is focused on that. Most of the time teaching is in German until it switches into French during secondary school. But there is always this guaranteed use there in whatever local dialects there are. Now, we compare that with us. At present, Scots gets trotted out for a week before Burnsnacht. It can feel like that. So having some kind of guaranteed time is worth, you know, which will cost, again, practically nothing. It's worth millions of pounds in the end up in terms of people not dropping out of school, as we often see in the North East, and also where I come from in Renfrewshire. People just cannot get through that barrier of what people think of them.
Thank you very much. Maxwell.
And we've got a final group of questions from Michelle Thompson, please.
Good morning, and I'm going to come back to you, Dr. Dempster, to talk a little more about the financing. Obviously, we can see in the financial memorandum some costs being accrued towards the Scottish administration and local authorities. And as you started to point out, I think other bodies, individuals or businesses haven't been assigned anything. Now, bearing in mind the discussion we've been having about, from a Gaelic perspective, where we basically got to the end of the symbolism road and we're looking for something more organic, how critical do you consider the fact that there's no additional funding whatsoever, despite your pleasure at the inclusion of Scots in this bill?
It was an incredible disappointment seeing that, not just for its almost universally stated across other organisations we work with that additional funding isn't present in this financial memorandum. From the Scots Language Centre perspective, just even this process has stretched us beyond our capacity. Staff are all volunteering a significant amount of time, which I'm trying to hold back, but we have targets to meet and people to talk to and relationships to maintain. More widely, a lot of folk were hoping for this organic, grown-up approach, which I think is quite different. There are different needs within different dialect areas. So places like Glasgow, I've tried to get organisations brought together, but it's spoken so widely within the communities that they don't see a need for it. But somewhere like the North East or Shetland, they see a need to produce this. So, but what is wanted in these places is funding for creative work within that. So that would be the basis of building these grown-up organisations. So even getting together a group to talk about Glasgow Scots or Dumfries Scots would require a drop of money for you to do that, and to have nothing to actually facilitate building this kind of grown-up organisation where there are hundreds of individuals working, but they can't bring together their audience into being American involved in it. I think for to go on the symbolic value and status value of having Scots in this bill, it needs to be backed up with some funding. One of the issues is with the fund being Gaelic and Scots, right? So we Scots as a whole gets less than 1%, Scots Language Centre gets 0.3% of that funding. Whenever, and this is with other bodies as well, whenever mayor funding is requested, we are keenly aware that part of that is asking for money to be taken away for Gaelic. So I think what's strongly required, and it could be put into this legislation, is that there are separate funding sources for that, because I'm a massive supporter of Gaelic, but I don't want to be taking money out of somebody's mouth for a try and run some project. So I think there needs to be a Scots budget much higher than it is, and something that would come out of the Scots strategy that we can as a community across Scotland decide where that money would be best spent to develop growing up.
Thank you very much for that. And perhaps, do you think that the earlier discussions about separating Scots out, whilst we all welcome, would definitely want to carry on with that, but that would enable both a really clear look at the needs of Scots, given the amount of people who already speak it, and so there's different measures required and different funding. Would that also be an idea? Because at the moment it's kind of lumped in with Gaelic, and you're right, it's a kind of zero-sum game, because we're all aware of the really difficult constraints on funding. Do you think that also, from the financial perspective, adds weight to separating Scots out from this bill and making it a standalone, perhaps?
I think, as I said, ourselves and generally within the community, we want the bill to go forward. So I think initially it's quite loose what will be required, the Scots language strategy and then requirements on education. So I don't think there's a necessity to separate it out from the bill into something separate, but I think it would be useful to have an amendment that separated the budgets.
But also speaking for a great many Scottish speakers as well, we want to see a Languages of Scotland bill. We want it to be recognised across all the languages, and hopefully later on languages like sign language would be included within the same provision. It's very important that we don't get into a situation, which was the case for years, where it was Scots versus Gaelic about everything.
Okay. And my last question then, everybody will always kind of comment that there's no matter what it is, there's never enough money. This is just a common theme. Assuming that there's a continuation and it's Scottish and Gaelic and it's 695,000, I think over 5 years was what is in the FM. Imagine you were fixed at that amount, and the approach that's been discussed thus far, really a kind of further enabling from a framework perspective for some of the good work to continue, and fully accepting your comments, Professor Gilligan, would you be looking to spend money in particular pockets and removing money from other ones? And I know that's quite a complex question, but I'm trying to tease out in a very difficult budgetary environment where the money is not enough, and we understand that, what would you do differently?
I think one important point that came through from the Scottish Government representatives this morning is that the existing Gaelic Act and then what is contemplated in this bill does involve knock-on expenditure by a range of other organisations. The Gaelic language plans have required Creative Scotland, Nature of Scotland, these various organisations to do various things for Gaelic, and that would continue. As I read the bill, for example, it does contemplate that there would need to be a noticeable increase in the provision of Gaelic learners' education. Now, education budgets are a tricky one because, in some sense, you know, if the council is educating these pupils through the medium of Gaelic, they're educating through the medium of English anyway. The additional spend is not great. But so the headline figure doesn't necessarily tell us what are going to be the obligations, the costs incurred through the various obligations that will ripple out either through direct obligations in the statute or things that will come through standards and guidance and so on and so forth. A very important difficulty with this, the idea of reallocating budgets from within there already, is that there are constituencies, and it is a difficult thing in terms of representing communities to, if you remove certain strands. I mean, you know, generally in society there is a view that thinks of arts funding as sort of frippery, you know, just cut the funding for opera and we'll spend it on fixing potholes. You know, that is a view, right? That would be very damaging in the Gaelic context. You know, Gaelic arts, for example, are considered very, very important to Gaelic culture. It would be very demoralizing to a lot of people who are deeply committed, really at the heart of the Gaelic community, if you start saying we're going to, you know, cut funding for mods and choirs and things like that, right? And use it on more practical things that will have immediate outcomes and so on and so forth. So it's, particularly with a fragile community, I think there are real difficulties in saying we're going to cut X versus Y. In principle, it's something that should be tried, but looking at the various elements that are out there, there's real damage in terms of just knowing the Gaelic communities I do, that would be very harmful in that sense. It's a very risky process.
Okay, thank you. Okay, thank you very much. And I'd like to thank you all for your time today, and that's the public part of our meeting now at an end. We'll consider our next item in private. So again, thank you very much, gentlemen, for your time this morning and afternoon.